All right, guys, we're here. We are live. Welcome to a new Poker Live podcast. My name is Jose Ingram, 1 aka Chicago Joey, joined today by my God, guys. I've been looking forward to this day for a long time. We're joined today by a guy who I have the most interesting conversations, debatably the most interesting conversations of anybody I talk to online. We talk about so many things that we can't talk about on the podcast, but we're joined by a man who's a tournament player, a man who owns a bar and nightclub. I think it's a bar and nightclub. It just might be a bar. We're going to find out more. A man who lives in Hungary, a man who's got an epic 2+2 poker goals and challenges thread that everyone follows along and he gives out great strategy in, a man who runs a poker coaching stable and coaches and just helps so many people get better at poker and lets them play poker, a man who's debatably one of the best and also plays some PLO cash. I'm not sure he's one of the best at PLO cash though, but a man that goes by the name of Pads 1161, aka Plano 8, aka Patrick Leonard. What's up, Poppy? Welcome to the podcast.
Good to be here. Thanks for the introduction. It was pretty epic.
Okay, hold on. I wanted to add in that a man who sends me videos of himself in Budapest at 3 a.m. walking through the streets and yelling out Poppy to random people and then running away. Patrick, yeah. Sorry, I forgot to add that in, kid.
Guilty.
All right, man. Welcome to the podcast. How you doing, buddy?
Good. Just as of late last night watching the main event, so pretty tired today. Just didn't do much. Went to KFC. It's Monday, you know. Every Monday I always tell myself I'm going to eat well and go to the gym, but I woke up at 4 p.m., went to KFC. Same old, unfortunately. But next Monday we'll try again, I guess.
So let me get this straight. You woke up. You woke up at 4 p.m. You said, I'm going to eat well today, and you walked to KFC. What'd you get at KFC? You get one of the snackers? You get, like, the popcorn chicken?
Classic menu, large fries. Yeah. I don't even ask anymore. They just know my order, you know?
You're a KFC reg.
I'm like, top reg, yeah. Like, Supernova Elite, and they're not taking away my reg back or anything. They're just giving me all, you know? They like it. They're very good to me. They treat me well.
You know, that's some hidden GTO right there, guys. And I hate to get into the strategy right away, but a good strategy if you're in a big city is to go frequent the same place often, get to know the people there, preferably a place that may or may not have. I don't want to make anybody. Let's not even get into that, man. How's it going, man? So, okay, you watched the main event last night. What'd you think about the main event? This is the big topic. If you're watching this back 5 months from now, 2 years from now, 4 years from now, last night was day one of the November 9. And Patrick, what'd you think about it, man?
I was underwhelmed. I think basically everybody played bad, apart from McKeon played okay. Everyone else, I think, played pretty. I was really excited about. I knew the final table was very inexperienced compared to last year. Like last year, you had Jacobson, Van Hoof, Felix, and some other guys who are like some of the best players in the world. And this year, you had mostly lower regs with not much experience. I was expecting most people to not really live up to expectations, but I thought Max Steinberg would do a lot better than he did. He comes from like heads up, sit and go background. So in heads up, sit and goes, when you have aggressive opponents, you start limping and not allowing them to go all in pre-flop and to put pressure on you. So when he had McKeon on his left, I was assuming he was going to be limping a lot and playing lots of pots with him, but he was raising and letting McKeon push him around, which was something I wasn't expecting. I didn't like it at all. It was pretty boring. I switched it off after a few hours. Hopefully tonight gets more interesting when McKeon starts playing aggressively and does some bigger pay jumps and stuff like that. But so far, I think it was pretty boring stuff.
Did you enjoy it every time? So let's say, for instance, you make a statement to me and then I sit here for 10 seconds and don't do anything.
Yeah, the time
came. Did you enjoy that? You enjoyed that part, right? Every time. So the guy on Stern and Nuva, this is the Nuva. Man, I just want to do an impression of Nuva who didn't see it. So the Stern guy sits there. Just like it's just no one open, it's just folds to him. He's like,
yeah.
And then he folds, and then Newville just sits. Newville's like sitting there like he's on ecstasy or something, just looking around, fucking happy to be there. And he's like, oh, I'm looking at my cards here. Looks at his cards, thinks, okay, folds. I'm like, what is happening every single time? It was. I asked some people on Facebook, Twitter, read over 2+2, read some social media stuff. I didn't find one person that said they enjoyed watching it. Not one person was like, I liked watching that last night. So
this Sten guy was coached by Jacobson, so Martin Jacobson coached him. So So I think Jakobsen knew this Stern guy was just like complete fucking crazy, and he's capable of just losing all his chips in any hand with like any two cards. Like, just he broke the bubble by like 5-bet and all in with 10-8 or something. So Jakobsen probably told him just take a long time on every decision and make sure you don't fuck up. And he probably just took it too literal and just like took like 5 minutes every time. I think going into the day, he'll be a little bit faster, and Jakobsen will probably tell him to like speed up a little bit, I would imagine. He probably is going to get like a warning, and McKeon's probably going to call clock on him quite early, I would imagine, stuff like this. So I think today will be a little bit faster, and Negreanu and Helmuth will give their speeches and stuff like this. So I think it'll be quite quick today, actually, compared to yesterday. Relatively quick.
Yeah, we'll see. I mean, obviously, I can't fault them for taking so long. They're playing for, what is it, $7 million without, you know, pieces and stuff like that. They playing for an alleged $7 million that they allegedly will get on their future earnings that they probably don't have all of them. I guess the legend, what is the guy? You remember the legend, New Blumenfeld, right?
Blumenfeld, yeah, he was a bit of a hero. Yeah.
I like how he got the legend for, so under the gun, open nine-handed, he 3-bets queen-8 suited from the big blind and gets the nickname the legend. When yeah. I consider that the nickname terrible, but I guess he gets the legend. So, I mean, it's a pretty cool nickname to have, for sure.
Yeah, Espandiari, I thought his commentary, like, to us, it's obviously bad, but I think to the public, he does actually pretty good commentary. Like, everything he says, like, I'm cringing, but if I was, like, an amateur watching, I think he does a pretty good job of, like, explaining basic, like, even, like, blockers. Like, he said blocker stuff, like, pretty well, you know, like, he's explaining, like, when you have an ace, it's less likely they have an ace, stuff like this. So I thought he did a good job, even though I think for, like, the professional players, he obviously didn't add any value, and it was quite cringy to watch.
I thought Antonio did pretty good job. I think Lon McCarron does. I posted this in the thread on 2+2. Like, he's either not learned anything in the past like 10 years he was doing commentary, or he's just really, really good at just setting up. So he says these like ridiculous things. You're like, can he fucking really think that? And then, yeah. But he sets Antonio up for a really easy answer, and Antonio can explain it to the general public. So I think he does a good job. I thought Norman Chad did a pretty good job last night. He was really funny. He sort of timed in that one time they showed the Stern, when Stern had some, like, you know, like everyone had their own little piece, like heartfelt piece where they said their piece and stuff like that. I think it was who said something ridiculous, and Norman Shad's like, well, that's, first of all, I can't remember. Do you remember that part?
Joe was being like very, like, he said he was going to go into the interviews and say as little as possible and come across like very grumpy, so they won't ask him questions. So in his interview, they were like, are you excited? And he was like, no, it's just another tournament. And then he just like closed his mouth and just looked at the camera. So it came off a little bit awkward, I guess, but I don't know. I think it was that.
Yeah, I'm excited for tonight. Obviously, there's six-handed. We're going to see some more fireworks. Hopefully, we see less tanking. I'm going to DVR it. I recommend everyone out there records it if you're in America, and then fast forward through it. Yeah, the tanking, because it just sort of becomes unbearable. Okay, well, last thing we're going to talk about that, and then we'll get on to the real excitement for this podcast. Who do you think is going to win? What's your prediction?
McKeon's going to win. I mean, he has to get pretty unlucky not to win, I think. The other guys are just going to bleed chips. I mean, this Beckley guy, I mean, I just think it's amazing, like, people can think so poorly about poker and make it this far in a tournament where, like, this tournament's all about making, like, post-flop decisions, and, like, that call he made with King High was just, like, incredibly, like, it just shows, like, no understanding. Like, McKeon's going to be betting the flop on ace-8-3. He defended the big blind, and then McKeon checked back the flop on ace-8-3. There's, like, no way with the way that it was set up that McKeon's going to check back, like, Queen High or Jack High. So that, like, calling down the river with King High just showed, like, a big misunderstanding of the general fundamentals, I thought. So that was, like, really weird how he got there. I think he has no chance to win. I think McKeon's just basically got locked up unless he blows up, but I don't think he will. I think he's better in control.
What do you think, a little wager here? You got McKeon, I got the field?
Okay.
What are the stakes going to be, Poppy?
$100. But you want a bit more or less? I don't know what
you're facing. Wait, you want a bit money on this? Okay, how much? Wait a second.
Well, what did you want to bet on? I don't know.
Wow, well, I was thinking something a little more exciting. I'll bet some money. I'll bet some fucking money on it. What do you think, $100?
$100, yeah, that's fine.
I'm pretty sure I have an edge here.
Yeah, you have an edge, but it's all right.
Okay, $100. I was going to bet something else. I wanted to bet some... we'll get into that later. Let's get into it. So, Patrick, where can we even start with you, man? Where do you think is like the best place to start? See, I know you a little better than most. Like, some guests I don't know at all. I've never talked to at all. You, like, I could go a lot of directions with. So I'm trying to think of the optimal way to go about. So I guess most, what do most people know you from? Do they know you from your epic 2+2 thread where you, like, it's a pretty sick thread. It's in Poker Goals and Challenges, if anyone's ever been in there. and you sort of, you update people on your life, you give away a lot of strategy, go in depth on a lot of things like that. Is that, you think, where people like most know you from, or do they like, what do, I guess, what do you think you're most known for in poker right now?
Like around about like 7 years ago, I used to be like a bit of an internet warrior. Like I used to like get into arguments on forums and be a little bit immature and naive, I'd say. And I had blogs all the time on different websites and stuff. And I always kind of, in poker, people are like scared to give out content, but I was always happy to just like say exactly how I play and how I try. I have always been a very exploitative poker player. Like I tried to just make people fall too much and stuff like this. And I've always kind of shown that out publicly. So people have kind of liked watching like big bluffs and videos of me playing like crazy and stuff like this. So I used to make videos for PokerStrategy.com. They have like 8 million members. And I worked there for like 3 years in Spain. And then from then I became like a professional poker player. And I had this blog on 2+2. I had a couple of blogs. This is my second one. I had another one where I went to Vegas and stuff at the time. And yeah, just I'm quite, I say like I'm decent at networking. Like I don't mind just talking to somebody and asking people for help. Like I think on Skype I have like 2,000 contacts or something. So I guess I've always just been kind of out there talking to people, not afraid to message someone. And
You're not afraid to message anyone, Poppy.
Yeah, so yeah, I think I'm not too bothered about that kind of stuff. The worst that someone can say is no, right? So I've always tried to get information off other people, surround myself with good poker players. And yeah, that's kind of how I guess. I used to be a journalist, first of all, before poker. Mm-hmm. So I used to like writing a lot. And then I went into this job at Poker Strategy as a consultant, first of all, and then worked like doing the education, like their videos and stuff. Yeah, and then I moved to Budapest, where I am now.
Cool. I didn't know any of that. That's pretty cool. So you start off as a journalist. So obviously you've got some good, jeez, my back. I played ball for 3 hours today. So if I make some funny faces and movements, guys, it's because I'm very sore. But obviously being a journalist helps you become a better writer, helps you make your blog more interesting, helps make more people be interested in reading it, following along and stuff like that. And it's, so you started a journalist, you start working at Poker Strategy Consultant. You just liked poker so much. I feel like a lot of those guys that get into poker from that background sort of never really like make it through poker. Like I don't feel like we see a lot of people who start off working at a poker company and then actually became successful at poker.
Yeah, I mean, in these companies, you're working like huge hours. So like I would work, like get into the office at 10 a.m., leave the office at 6 or 7 p.m. and then you go home, you have dinner, whatever else. And then you only have like a couple of hours to play poker. You don't have much time to study, stuff like this. So I think for like the three years I worked at Poker Strategy, I didn't fulfill my potential in terms of like ability as a poker player because I didn't have time to study and to run sims and be in the lab and stuff. But I learned a lot about the bad things that poker players do. Like we'd have all these members who would make us a lot of money, like raking money on the sites, but they would always lose their money because they would lose it on women or gambling, or they would have bad game selection. So I kind of learned all the bad things that poker players do when I worked there, which was really good because it meant that I didn't lose all my own money. Like usually you learn from mistakes, but I didn't learn from my own mistakes. I learned from other people's mistakes, from speaking to them every day. Like I was speaking to the VIPs every day and like they would tell me, oh my God, I'm a fucking idiot. I've done this. So I'd be like, yeah, that's fucking stupid. Why would you do that? And then it just built into me like, oh yeah, obviously don't put all my money on roulette because I'm going to be broke and I can't play anymore, stuff like this. But yeah, like you said, I like to write and I like to be quite emotive when I write and to basically say like exactly how I feel. So like I have a blog and I'm not afraid to say like, yeah, today I feel really bad. I feel depressed. I was crying, whatever. I don't think I've ever said I was crying or anything like that. But if I was, I wouldn't be afraid to tell people about it, you know, because I think writing is interesting when people are honest. There's too many people who like make coaching videos or they write blogs and stuff. And it's just about trying to make themselves sound better or feel better. And a lot of people think that about me. Like they think that I try to make myself look good in these blogs. But if I think I've done something well, I write down like I paid fucking good today or something like that, you know, and it can come across as arrogant. But some days I will write like I paid terrible today and I write that too. But yeah, on the topic of writing, I wrote you a little poem. Do you want it now or not?
Of course I want it. Yeah, I want it. Give it to me, Poppy.
So like, there's a lot of people who won't understand some things inside this poem. It's only like you said before, my nickname is Pleno 8. I used to write poetry, like my first girlfriend and for other people, I used to write some of these poems. And It's always like rhyming couplets, so very simple poems, like 8 lines in four two-line rhyming couplets. So there's a reference about Kate Hall here. I hope she doesn't take offense anyway, but let's see. All right, so I haven't read it out loud, so I need to just read it quickly.
Okay.
All right. I've known this guy for about 100 days. At first, I thought he was a bit of a douche, but now I laugh at what he says. His podcasts are legendary. He finds the best guests, like Ben 86 and that one with the breasts. He takes it seriously. He's the podcast pro. He lives his life the right way. He's definitely GTO. I try to be as honest as I can. Sometimes I'm a little bit misunderstood. I'm really only coming on today for the podcast run good.
I like it, man.
What do you think, Papi?
Trying to seduce me with this spot? Are you trying to seduce me right now?
Yeah. What do you think? Would it work?
I'm in. I'm ready. You want me to take off my shirt and give me a massage right now or what? What do you want to do?
I thought I'd bring you just a little one, you know, show my appreciation.
Wait, what did you say? There's a reference to Kate Hall in there?
Yeah. I said his podcasts are legendary. He finds the best guests, like Ben 86 and the one with the breasts. I was trying to like play on her like hating of feminism.
I know. I mean, I'm not going to tell her you said that. Don't tell her, Patrick. Please no one tell Kate Hall he said that.
I like her a lot. She's good. I think her podcasts are underrated. They're very good. She's very nice, I think.
You like her?
Yeah, she's good. And she thinks well about poker too, I think.
Well, I appreciate the poem. I know, maybe I got to get into poem. Do you find that writing poems to your friends or, you know, potential other people, is that like a GTO approach to things?
Well, it depends on who they are, I guess.
Give me some poem tips, Poppy. Give me like two tips for writing poems, and I'm gonna write a poem. I'm actually gonna come up with a poem back for you during the podcast. I'm gonna think about it while we're doing the podcast. So give me two or three tips on how to write an appropriate poem.
Wow, that's tough. Tips. I mean, just you just have to work a little while. I mean, you just use very basic words like days and says, stuff like this. You know, like words which are easy to rhyme. Don't use like crazy long words or crazy technical stuff. Just make it simple and try to make it somewhat humorous is probably going to be the best, I guess.
I didn't get that. Can we try that again? That didn't give me any tips, man. You get to give away strategy. Okay. Days and says, no crazy technical words. What else? Come on. I need like a couple tangible ones I can use for my poem about you.
You just use simple words. It's very, just try, say a word and try to rhyme it, right?
Okay.
So like, what rhymes with poppy?
Sloppy. Okay.
Huh?
Poppy.
Sloppy.
Poppy. Sloppy. Yep.
This is really sloppy poppy. I don't think it really rhymes. So
poppy.
Tappy. You know what tappy means, right? In French.
What does tappy mean to you, kid?
All in. It means all in French.
Tappy means all in. You know what tappy means in English?
My housemate is French.
Oh, your housemate's French. Shout out to your housemate. Can he say entrepreneur for me, please?
Entrepreneur? Yeah.
No?
Yeah.
No, he said it. Say it again one more time.
All right. Entrepreneur.
God, I fucking love French people. Can you say casino for me?
Casino?
Yes, thank you. Yeah, thank God. Yes. I love French people so much. One of my favorite French people, Alexander Dreyfus, says entrepreneur and cuss. I don't know how he says casino entrepreneur, but he says it so cool. And I just.
Yeah, I love it when the French Canadian guys speak. It's pretty nice to listen to French Canadians. I've never spoken to a French Canadian girl before, actually.
Yeah, I was gonna say, like, what are French Canadian women? It sounds like if French Canadian men are this exciting, then like how cool would it be to talk to a French Canadian woman?
I know. Who knows?
Yeah, you know, I mean, whatever. Yeah, it's where do you gotta go? I think you gotta go to Montreal to find them, though.
Yeah, probably. Guess that's the best place to start.
I'm out. I'm not going to Montreal.
Never been to Canada before, actually. Was thinking of moving. Would be maybe next year, Vancouver or something.
Vancouver's fun. That's like a great place. So, I mean, you've never been to Canada at all, right?
It is really cold though, like in winter and stuff. So.
It's not that cold. I lived there for a year and a half. It wasn't really that cold during winter. It snowed only one time. It barely got that cold. It rained a lot though. So it's like 40 degrees Fahrenheit rain. And yeah, during the winter, I mean, it's not very fun. Yeah.
Yeah. But, I live in Budapest. You've been to Budapest? I know you came to Europe last year doing like a little road trip or something, right? You went to Germany or something?
Yeah, I was in Belgium and Germany this summer, but I've never been to Budapest. Okay, tell us about Budapest. You live in Budapest, Hungary. It's in Eastern Europe. Tell us about it. I don't know much about it. I'm sure a lot of people out there don't know much about it as well.
Budapest is it's very good. It's like I like cities which are compact where you can like walk from one side of the city to the other city. Like cities like London and Paris and New York, where you have to like take a train for like an hour to get to somewhere you want to go to. Like if you want to go to a good restaurant, sometimes you have to go like an hour on a train, on the tube. I like being able to just like walk through the city, see the city being alive and just like stumbling into somewhere. Budapest is very compact. Like you could go from one side to the other, like in the city center in like 10, 15 minutes, I'd say. It's very cheap. Europe is like very cheap in general.
When you say cheap, I always hear this. Can you just tell what is cheap comparable? Like what is rent? Like what makes it so cheap?
You can always be as bold as you want to be. Like if you want to go and live in somewhere for like 5,000 euros a month, I mean, you can find somewhere, I'm sure, you know, but there's a lot of places which have like if you're like a modest poker player and you just want to like live somewhere in a decent place, you probably pay like 500, 600 euros, I think, somewhere for somewhere good.
Nice. Okay.
Drinks are very cheap. Like a beer is around about 1.20 euro or something like that for a beer. Food is very cheap. The weather's good. I mean, like it's winter now, but I went outside today with just a jumper on. It's fine. The women are beautiful. The internet's good. There's a lot of students. So like where I've lived in the past, like in Newcastle, where I'm from, basically everyone goes out on Friday and Saturday night, and midweek people don't really go out as much. They obviously go out, but it's not as busy as the weekend. But when you're a poker player, sometimes like you really want to go out on like a Wednesday night and have like a crazy night. And Budapest is a great place for that because there's a lot of international students here who have been living here for like, they only live here for like 6 months at a time, like they come for a placement. Mm. So basically they go out every night. There's a lot of Brazilians, Spanish, Argentinians. So there's like a really nice, like a good feeling about the city. Every night there's parties, stuff like this. And yeah, this is kind of how I got into owning this bar. Like my friend is Argentinian and he told me he was going to buy this bar. He told me all the finances and stuff. And I was like cheekily asking if I could buy a percentage. And he was like, yeah, why don't you come and like be an owner with me? So I said, yeah, sure. Then we did it. And our place always has like every night there'll be like lots of people there who are like from all students or young professionals, stuff like this, because there's lots of jobs in Budapest. Like it's very, the salaries are very low. So the companies have like call centers here and stuff. So a lot of people come from like Italy, France, wherever else to come and work here. And it's a good city for them because expenses are low and it's a fun city to live in and stuff. So it's a very lively city. I'd say it's like perfect for someone like 25 to 30. Like,
so you get cheap, beautiful women. You got a lot of people transplanting there for 6 month time period. A lot of people are there. A lot of poker players are there too, aren't there?
Yeah, I mean, when I first came here, there was only like maybe 10 or 15 guys maximum, probably like 10. And now, I mean, there's just new people coming every week. There's lots of French guys. A lot of my friends from England have moved over here. There's Americans, Canadians, everything, Portuguese. I mean, because all these like countries are like regulating poker, then it's very hard to stay in your own country. Like Portuguese guys have to leave and live somewhere. And like you can't live in France, you can't live in Spain, you can't live in Italy, you can't live in England because it's too expensive. So like you're left with like Prague, Budapest, these kind of cities. And these cities are like really good cities to live in when you're like a young guy who's just looking. You can get rent pretty quickly, like you can rent somewhere for like 3 months, stuff like this. So it's a good place for people to move to for a couple of months and like leave it as a base, I guess. The airport's very close by. Yeah, downsides, I guess it's cold, like December, January time. Mm. But there's not many downsides, I don't think. I mean, I'm probably biased just because I like it so much. I'm sure other people don't like certain stuff about it, but I'm pretty content here. I don't think I'll move for a long time until I'm forced to, I guess. I used to live in Spain I used to live on the beach until they basically regulated poker and stopped allowing me to play poker in Spain. So I had to move to Hungary.
So you said that your mom's watching this. Shout out to your mom, by the way. Do you ever get to see her? Is she back home in England? Does she ever come to Budapest, check it out and stuff, see what your life's like there?
Yeah, I mean, because most of the time for my parents, they like to travel a lot and they like to, especially when I was living in Spain, it was very nice for them to come, and especially when the weather was good, to come and like spend like a week or 2 weeks with me. In Budapest, they've came like a couple of times too. Yeah, I mean, I have a good relationship with my parents. I probably speak to my parents, I would say, more than any other poker player speaks to their parents. Like, I probably speak to them once a day, like on Skype or FaceTime or something like this. I think I blogged about this, like, kind of going off in a tangent here somewhat, but we had a guy who had steak he wrote to me one day, like 2 weeks ago, telling me that it was a Sunday, and he told me like, it's quite a big thing. But anyway, he told me, I wasn't sure if I should say it, but anyway, I started and also go with it. He told me that he had to leave his tables on a Sunday, which is like the big day for playing poker, because his girlfriend had like committed suicide in his house or whatever like that. So it kind of, it was kind of like a big thing. Like it's like a reality check. It just shows you like to always make sure you speak to friends and family and stuff like this. I know I have a lot of friends who don't speak to their parents or speak to their friends as much. Like I think I'm also guilty, like not speaking to my friends from like real life as much, because it's sometimes you just take it for granted, you know, like you just let these kind of relationships just fizzle out, and then you almost become strangers with people who you grew up with, if that makes sense. Like you have these guys you spent every day with for like 10 years, and then you spend like 6 years speaking to them like on their birthday and nothing else. There's so much time which I spend like procrastinating, just doing nothing, like lying in bed or just being on YouTube watching prison documentaries or something. And just like having like a 5 minute conversation with someone is going to be good, I think. And it's kind of a goal that I've set myself, just to speak to people who I haven't spoken to in a long time more frequently, because I think it's important not just to have poker friends as well. It's good to be balanced. And if all you speak about is how to play GTO and how to check raise and stuff like this, then I think your life becomes quite one-dimensional. So yeah, that's kind of a goal, which I think this is something which I've done very poorly over the last 7 years. Like I've been very poker orientated and just focusing on how to succeed in poker rather than to how to succeed in life. And I've let things slip, like health and fitness and whatever else. And I guess like friendships from people who I've grew up with is one of those things as well. So that's something which I'll look to kind of improve on, I guess, next year or for the rest of this year or whatever else.
I think that's something that I've thought about a lot recently. So just the idea of keeping in touch with people you knew from before or people that were your friends at one point in time. So when you're talking to these people, like this is what this sort of I know there's going to be some people out there who have really good input on this. And I certainly don't know how to approach the situation, because I've been in the poker world playing poker for the past 7 or 8 years. I don't really think much about keeping in touch with my older friends. And that's like when you're talking to them, you know, it's like you have these pretty surface conversation for the most part. Like, I feel like there's not really much being said as like, oh, what are you up to? Like, oh, like, okay, you're working at your job. Like, that's cool. How's your girlfriend? How's your wife? Oh, they're doing well. It's like, what exactly should you talk about with these people? Like how, like, I mean, yeah, it's like the conversation isn't very, and for me, the conversation, like, I feel like it's just not very interesting. I'm sort of just doing it to do it. And maybe there's like, I'm sort of trying to figure out how I should approach it so that I feel like, you know, it's, yeah. I don't know. I feel like I'm thinking about it wrongly, but yeah.
I agree. Like, I mean, I've like opened like Facebook conversations and like gone to type and just being like blank, you know, like, I'm like, what the fuck do I say? Like I say hi, then I mean, and these are people who are like your best friends, you know? And it's sometimes, if you're together, when you're together in a room, like your energy just kind of connects automatically. Do you know what I mean? Like you talk, you just naturally, and when you're in a bigger group, it's easier to like, you're talking with one person and with someone else, and like, it's quite awkward to just start a conversation and then just end it like quite quickly, because you don't have much to say, like, hi, how are you? What are you up to? How was the week? Okay, have fun, you know what I mean? Like, right. It's quite hard to have one of these like deep conversations when you want to as well, because like with poker, like you're busy a lot of the time when they're free, right? So like when they're at work, I'm sleeping, and when they're like finished work, I'm playing poker usually. So like, and I'm not gonna like make like a diary appointment with someone so I can have like a 5 minute conversation with them. So like often it just becomes more convenient to not speak to these people. Do you know what I mean? Which is definitely a shame, and definitely something which I'd like to kind of, maybe someone can recommend something. I'm not sure. I can't see the comments or whatever, but maybe someone recommends some kind of way. I'm not sure. Something which I've thought about, but never really been able to.
It's like it's a weird thing. It's like, okay, how do I approach the idea of keeping in touch with people or just like non-poker friendships in general, which I think if you ask any normal person, normal relatively speaking, outside of poker, that they'd be like, that's a weird fucking question. But I'm sure there's people that have this question too. And like, I know how to keep in touch with my poker friends because, you know, like there's so many people that you're friends with that you never see because, you know, for instance, you live in Budapest. Some of your poker friends might live in Canada. Some might live in the United States. Maybe they don't live in the United States. Nah, never mind. Take that one back. Some of them live in London. Some of them live in Australia. So it's like when we're used to talking to our friends, but realizing we're not going to see them for a while, maybe if ever, you know, like we never might see them. Like we might not see them for 5 years. But with like, we have something in common, which is poker. But with the, you know, with like the older friends, it's like, what do we really have in common sometimes? Like if our goals are, you know, poker and main as a big first goal, and then a secondary third goal is our fitness and stuff like that. You know, it's like, well, do we talk about that with them? And
often like they're going to want to hear about poker kind of thing, you know, and it's going to be like one-sided, like, yeah, you talk about poker, and like the questions are like unintentionally, they're like quite naive, like, oh, how much did you lose this week, or how much did you win this week, or whatever, you know, like, mm-hmm. So yeah, it becomes like quite boring for poker players to speak about themselves, you know, like, even though it's fine, like it's good conversation stuff, but it can become quite tame to constantly just like answer the same kind of repetitive kind of questions which don't really make sense to you, you know what mm-hmm. I mean? But yeah, I think it's good. Yeah, I like to, yeah. I'm not sure. I think most of my friends live in London now. They're mostly like finance guys, like all like doing well in their jobs and in their careers.
So like, what do you get? So like, you talk to them, and I guess it's like, what was the conversation about? Like, what have you tried this now? So you said this is a goal. Are you actively working on this goal now? Or is this something that you want to get working towards?
Yeah, I've been making more of an effort with more people recently, especially. I mean, usually it's easiest just on their birthday, you know, like when someone's birthday comes up on like Facebook, you'll message them, like, oh, happy birthday, and then you'll say thanks, and then how are you, and you'll just lead off. But I think doing it more frequently is better, I think, especially as like they're going to have 100 people writing them on that day too, you know. And I think it shows, like, if someone writes to me, like if I have a friend from not from poker, if he writes to me on like a random Wednesday and he just like starts a conversation with me, like, obviously my very best friends I'm speaking to regularly. Like, it's not like I don't speak to anyone outside of poker, you know. And I have a lot of friends from my football team in Hungary and stuff like this. But my friends from home, like, who are very good friends, but that I don't speak to much. If one of them wrote to me on a random day, I'd be, like, very happy and about it, you know. Like, if one of them wrote, I'd be very happy to answer any question they ask me, and I'd be very whatever. And I think they would be the same from me too, like, because they don't have as many friends who are outside their social circle. Do you know what I mean? Like, when you're not a poker player, I'm not trying to like sound stupid here or anything, but when you're not a poker player, most of your friends are still your friends who you're friends with. Do you know what I mean? Like, if I'm like the kind of guy who they haven't seen in 6 months, if I speak to them, then maybe like that's like exciting or interesting for them too, just as I would be as interested in them writing to me as well, you know, and intrigued about each other's life and stuff, I think. But yeah, I haven't gone home for Christmas for like 4 or 5 years. Usually that's when everyone comes back. I think this year I'll make like an effort to go back and be with my family, be with my friends and stuff. So,
yeah, it was the same way. I didn't go back home for Christmas for like 2 or 3 years when I was living in San Diego and living in Vancouver. And that was definitely like, that's a reason why I decided to relocate for a little while around my family, was because I spent so much time away from my family on holidays and my little brother and stuff like that. So that's like a big reason why I've stuck around here. And I'm pretty happy with the decision, because I know at some point in time I'm going to move away. And, you know, it's like you always want to come home, but maybe it just comes down to effort. Maybe it's just making better effort as
it's also a life skill. Like, this is like, it's almost a life skill when you're like self-absorbed in poker. Like, you don't learn a lot of life skills, you know. Like, one of the reasons why I have this staking company, it's like, it's not to make money initially. Like, obviously I'm going to make money from it, and I want to make money from it, spend a lot of time on it, but in the future, I don't want to be a full-time poker player. Like, in 6 or 7 years, I want to be running businesses and doing some startup stuff. Mm-hmm. So like, I decided that when it comes in 6 years, I'm going to be lacking all of these life skills and job skills that everyone else who's working already has an advantage on me. So I thought I'll start a staking company. And then in the staking company, I'm going to learn, I'm going to make a lot of mistakes, but it's something that I'm experiencing. Like, I understand poker, so it's easier to make mistakes and learn from in poker than in 6 years when I'm going to hire somebody. I'll ask better questions in an interview that I should have asked that I realized in the staking company, stuff like this, you know. I'll understand like how to manage people better. I'll understand like how to speak to people better. Because I found myself at the start of the staking company, like, if someone made like a really big mistake, I would be like very kind of angry at them. I'd be very kind of dismissive. I'd like write to the other guys like who I own the company, like, this fucking idiot did this or this. Like, how can he be so stupid? And like, that was like definitely a mistake. Like, I shouldn't have been like that. I should have been more open-minded and like realized the mistake they're making, why they're making the mistake, and then help them not make the mistake next time. Which, if I go into having a company, like having 50 or 100 employees, then I'll like know now better how to speak to people and have better life skills because of the staking company. And that's one of the reasons why I have the bar and the stake and stuff. It's not to make money. Like, I'm not trying to make X amount of money with the bar. I'm trying to like learn some stuff. Like, there was a story with an accountant. Like, we had an accountant, and I mean, I've never spoken to an accountant in my life. I mean, I've had no reason to speak to an accountant before. And when we bought the bar, he had to do like all the math for like the last 1 year, like all the finance stuff. And we told him, okay, we'll pay you like whatever an hour, like 100 euros an hour or 50 euros an hour, whatever it was. We told him, yeah, you shouldn't really spend so much time. But we didn't write anything down. And then the next week he came to us and he was like, okay, you owe me X amount of money. And we were like, what do you mean? This is crazy. And he's like, yeah, we spent 120 hours doing this stuff and whatever. And we thought it was only going to take him like 3 or 4 hours. So we were expecting to pay like 5 or 10 hours work. And he ended up doing like 100 hours or 50 hours, whatever it was, like 10 times more than we expected. And now this is something like, if I ever speak to an accountant again, I'll make sure like it's written down, you know, like don't spend more than the hours that we feel is necessary, you know, because accountants, especially, they go into every single detail. They don't want to get anything wrong. They're very meticulous with what they do. So that was something which I learned from the bar. That kind of stuff, you know.
Sounds like you got hit with the accountant shuffle there, Poppy.
I think so, yeah. It was my landlord, actually, at the time as well.
Sounds like you got hit with the shuffle. It sounds like a professional worked you over there quite well and took you to the showers a little bit.
Yeah, it's fine. That's part of the learning process, I guess.
Definitely, I like that way to look at it, man. My boy Metalhead. Poppy! Metalhead says, don't have any idea who this guy is, but that's what's awesome about the podcast. Always great to learn about new people. Only 10 minutes in, and he's well-spoken, allegedly digging it. Shout out to Metalhead, man. Shout out to little Poppy Metalhead. Shout out to Baby Metalhead. Shout out to the wife Metalhead, man. Much love. Thanks for watching, buddy. You guys, if you have any questions or comments, put them on YouTube, put them on Twitch. And if I see any good ones, I will mention them. If you see me grabbing my microphone, it's because I broke the stand and it keeps hitting me in the face like this. So I have to hold it in front of me right now. And yeah, right. You were on Twitch for a little bit, right? You stream on Twitch at all? You don't.
I was the original podcaster, poker podcaster, actually. Like,
no, you weren't.
There's some videos on YouTube of like 4 or 5 years ago me doing.
That's not an original poker person. No, you're using the term original poker podcast.
Compared to on Twitch.
Okay. So my podcast started on YouTube, first of all. But okay, so you allegedly started the first poker podcast on Twitch.
There was some. I was nowhere near as good as you were. I was very amateur. I did Timex and Ben Wilanowski. You know Ben Wilanowski, Never Scared B? He's like a tournament guy. I used to Twitch once a week I used to do like live coaching. And we used to have like 1,000 people come every week. It was pretty good. And then one day Twitch wrote to us saying, poker's illegal, you're not allowed to Twitch anymore. And we had this big following and stuff. So I just showered me and I didn't think anything of it. Then like 3 years later, we had all Jason Sullivan coming back and stuff. So it was kind of confusing how that happened, but poker was illegal on Twitch for like 2 or 3 years, I think. But yeah, I've thought about doing it since and I was going to do it. And I think I did it with the Wild Hungarian, my friend's girlfriend there. And it's okay. I think when you're playing high stakes, you give away a little bit too much information a lot of the time. Especially like how you view people, like poker in tournaments is like a complete different thing to poker in cash games. So like, if I did a cash game podcast, cash game Twitch, I'd be like, yeah, I see that this time because of my range, blah, blah, blah. In tournaments, it's very much like, yeah, this guy is going to fold too much, so I'm going to exploit him. Like the Swedish guys do this too much. The Canadian guys do this too much. Like player pools definitely played too very similar. Like just an example I can think of, like if the board is something like 9-8-4-2 double flush draw, and you bet the flop, bet the turn, and the river's a brick, like it pairs the board, then like guys from Sweden, I'm not going to say what they do, but they all do something too much on this river. So you can do certain things against them that like Canadian guys do the opposite of, you know? So like, if I was starting saying all this on a Twitch thing, then I'd get like all nationalities like going after me and stuff like this. So it's hard to give away information on Twitch. And I'm I wouldn't want to do like half-heartedly, like I wouldn't want to do it just to have a following. If I did it, I'd want to do like 100% kind of thing, say everything that I know. Which is one of the reasons why I don't really watch Run It Once videos. Like a lot of the stuff the coaches do on these sites. I mean, I was watching this cash game coach. I won't say who he is, but I watched like 10 of his videos and he plays very standard in his videos and doing nothing crazy at all, just playing very small ball, stuff like this. And then I played against him on the tables and he's like playing a completely different strategy. You know what I mean? So like, it feels like he's just doing the video just to like pick up the pay packet and get the variance stream money, without giving any information off, you know? So I think that's kind of why coaching videos are kind of not valuable anymore, because the stuff that people do to be big winners, they don't tell people about, do you know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
So I think
who is the coach? You don't want to name the coach?
No, I don't want to call him. He seems like a nice guy.
Okay. Tyler Forrester, my boy Google's nose. It better not be my boy Google, man.
No, he's good. He's good.
Okay. Better not be my fucking boy Google's nose. That's my guy. I love that guy, Tyler Forrester.
You ever made a training video before, like for a site?
I made a training video for YouTube. I played four tables. I played three tables of 50-cent dollar full ring and one table of 25-50 full ring.
All right.
Once. I made it in 2009, 2010. It was a three-part episode, and it was one of the best training videos ever alive, but I realized I was giving away way too much GTO strategy in it that I decided that it's better, not a good idea, and then I never made a video after that.
Do you watch videos, though?
I watch some videos, yeah. I watch a lot of PLO videos. I watch Phil Galfond PLO videos. Shout out to Phil Galfond.
Yeah, I should definitely watch more PLO videos. I'm far from an expert in...
Keep coming. Come on in, Poppy. Come on in the 2-5 Zoom pool. They love you, I'm sure, in there, man.
Yeah. I dabble too much in those pools. It's almost like a drug. Like, when you play those, like, 400-500 Zoom PLO tables, it's just so easy to free bet, like, 50% every hand and just get into all these crazy pots. And I don't really know what I'm doing. I'm playing too many tables and too many decisions. And I don't know the equities and stuff like this. It's definitely somewhat irresponsible of me, but it's fun. It is fun.
Fucking tournament players. I love them, man. This is why we like tournament player. I think every PLO cash game regular loves it when the tournament players hop into the Zoom pool.
Yeah, of course. Same sort of the Nullimit guys as well. They have special color codes for us. But yeah, the cash game guys, like the old color code tournament guys, you know, like.
Ooh, that's a good point. So like, when Timex comes into the 2-5 Zoom pool, do you think the regulars make like a Timex color note for him or something?
Yeah, I'd imagine so, yeah.
That makes sense. We're getting some good. You're bringing out the good comments today, Hans. You're asking a lot of good questions, my friend. I'll try to remember the questions, but you're asking a lot of questions, Poppy. Hold on. I gotta find Hans. Ask you a good question. Hold on.
Can I see the thing?
It's distracting, Poppy. It's distracting. I'm telling you. But you can check it out. The link to YouTube that I tagged you on Twitter. You can open that link and pop out the chat. Hans says, Hans Van Wav. If I take my girlfriend there for a city trip, will you kidnap me and play a Sunday session together? We can smoke weed and be buddies like Full Flush advocates.
I've never smoked weed before, so I wouldn't do that. But do you think, I mean, it happens quite often. Like, poker players come to Budapest often, they message and go to my bar for a drink or go for dinner or whatever. So
okay. There awesome. You go, Hans. Hit him up, Poppy. Send him some love.
What's his girlfriend gonna do when we play, though?
What's Ben up to? What's your roommate? What's he doing?
How's the status, Ben?
45.
I'm saying that's what he can do when she's in town. You know, hang out with her a little bit.
Ah, okay. Sure.
Show her the casino. Show her his entrepreneurship and stuff like that. That's the typical French things that French people do.
Yeah, sure. Sounds good. Where's Hans from?
I think Hans might be from the Netherlands, if I had to guess. Christoph says, Joey, first time watching live. Hair doesn't look GTO. What's up with that? Is that something you edit afterwards before uploading?
Your hair or my hair?
I love you. He says my hair's not looking GTO today. It's been dry. It's like it's a wetter look right now, but it's been dry lately, and it's like.
I think your sides need to go shorter now.
I got a haircut tomorrow, 12 p.m. I agree. I'm cutting the sides. I'm gonna shave it down to nothing, and then shave the back to nothing, and then get the hair. Get
what about facial hair? Never facial hair.
Well. I can't really grow facial hair. I'm not sure what's wrong. I want to get the Daniel Negreanu treatment where I get surgery and like this side of my face, but I can't grow.
Is it surgically put on his face or is it natural?
I don't want to speak for him. I'm not sure. I'm allegedly, I think he got hair implants. I believe he said something like that.
On his face or on his head?
I think on his head. I don't know. Maybe his face. I don't fucking know. Maybe. Can you get it on your face? Is that possible?
I don't know. Why not?
Hold on. Let me just. Can you get facial hair implants?
The real GTO.
Beard transplant. I guess you can. I'm not sure. If anyone's got facial hair surgery, please let me know in the chat. Let me know what it was like. Thank you very much. So, yeah, Hans says it was kind of it was not a joke. Now you're saying it's a joke because I asked it on the air, man, but that's okay. Okay,
one bad thing about living in Hungary is the government is very right-wing. The people are not so accepting of minorities and stuff like this, which is something which I haven't experienced the negatives part. Like when the refugees were coming over from Syria, the Hungarians basically just didn't accept them at all. They kicked them out of the country. Like thousands of people went and threw rocks at them where they were staying, stuff like this. The government's very anti-Gypsies, very anti-Jews, very anti-Blacks. So for that kind of stuff, like it's definitely not a, you could feel unsafe if you're like a certain minority somewhere. They're very against gays and stuff like this. It's for that kind of stuff, it's maybe I don't see it, so I'm somewhat oblivious to it, but I'm sure someone could have like a bad experience because of it. So yeah, I guess that would be the bad part of living in Hungary potentially.
So do they not like Americans?
Americans is fine. Americans is fine. It's more like they're very anti-Gypsies and Jewish, I think. That's like the two minorities they try to like push against, I would say.
Okay, I was going to ask you, when you were talking about tournaments and you talked about streaming on Twitch tournaments, do you think that the guys that stream tournaments on Twitch are at a big disadvantage the more and more they stream? So obviously, like I mean, Jake Carver is not really like grinding in the streets a lot, but there are other a lot of players. There's obviously like my boy Jimmy Stapler in the chat. Shout out to my boy Jimmy. He's in the chat. I know he streams a lot of his tournaments. Do you think somebody like him is at a pretty big disadvantage if he streams himself playing these same tournaments and he's playing, you know, two tables, four tables at a time?
Not really, because like most people who watch these streams are not professional poker players. Like I will watch the stream for like 5 minutes at a time or whatever, you know, like when he's playing, I'm either playing or I don't want to be in the house watching him play. You know, like most professional players, especially in higher stakes games, like they're not watching.
Right. Twitch. Okay. But when they're playing, so if you're playing the same tournament, someone streaming the same tournament, you're going to have the tournament open here on mute. And that way, if something happens or if you happen to come up to that table, which is a very rare scenario at tournaments. Let me think. There's a lot of people in tournaments. It's a very rare scenario. So that's a good point.
You can use it to your advantage too. Like tournament poker is always about leveling your opponents, like being one step ahead of your opponents. Like basically everyone in poker thinks that I like bluff every single hand. And if I bluffed every single hand, I couldn't win, right? Like I use it to my advantage and get paid off in good spots too. So if you're streaming and you can always like, if you're clever enough, you can always like level your opponents. But I mean, it's obviously sophisticated to do that and you need to be very clever, but there's definitely ways of how you can use it to your advantage too, I guess. And the side income that these guys make, like the top guys like Jamie and Jay Carver, they make more money like this than the EV that they give off from playing, you know? Like if they give off X EV, their Y of income is a lot higher than the EV they're giving off, you know? So if you lose 2,000 in EV and you make 5,000 in revenues, then it's obviously plus EV, you know? But there's some guys who have like 10 followers and they don't do it properly, then it's stupid.
I'm not referring to the 10 fucking followers. I'm talking about the guys who
I don't know that they stream, you know, like a guy who only has 10 followers. I don't know that he streams on Twitch. Like the only people who I know stream on Twitch are like four guys and they're the best guys who are making lots of money. Like the guys who have 10 followers, I don't even know that they Twitch. I don't check every day to see who's Twitching and stuff. You know?
So what about, says, what about Rupert and Poker Devil? So those guys stream, they play similar stakes tournaments that you play. Are you like having these tournaments open? Are you ever like, it seems like they're giving you this information. It's you take some time to at least, or you'd hire someone to watch it and give you information on what they're doing potentially.
They don't give any read specific information out. I don't think they're just listening to music most of the time. They're speaking maybe 5% of the time, I'd say. Rupert's a friend of mine. I think does it quite well. He's quite interesting. He's quite a funny guy. And so when he does speak, he's usually saying something quite funny. He's not speaking much when he speaks. He's like fun to watch, listens to good music and stuff like this. And when he speaks, he's not speaking for the sake of speaking, you know? So I don't watch the Poker Devil. I choose my hood against him, I guess. It's enough, I guess.
So you don't think if you streamed and did that, you wouldn't want to do that? You'd want to go all in terms of talking about strategy and players?
I think so, yeah. I think so. I'm not sure. Maybe some guys are like videoing the streams and then watching them afterwards. But the thing is, in poker, everyone is so lazy. Like in tournament poker, like I have this reputation that I'm this hardworking guy, and I'm so far from that. Like I work, I would say I work very, very, very hard in relatively compared to everybody else. But compared to my capacity, I'm super lazy. Like I'm not working 5 hours a day like I could be. You know, I'm working maybe 1 or 2 hours a day. And it's only a lot because everyone else is working no hours a day in tournaments. Like these guys are just like, they're complete rufflers. Like they're not working. They wake up hungover and play a session or whatever. They don't prepare. They're like playing with no HUD. They're playing on their laptop, whatever else. Like I do more than the minimum. Like I do work like semi-hard, but like compared to what I could do, I'm very, very lazy, you know? And the thing is in tournaments, like even if someone could get some EV out of you on Twitch, like they're just too lazy to do it, you know? And that's why tournaments are like beatable now, and they'll probably be beatable for a long time. Like after the PokerStars changes, it may change because like a lot of hardworking guys, like PLO guys or Sit and Go guys or Hyper guys that do work very hard every single day, they're going to come over to tournaments and it's going to make the higher stakes tournaments difficult. And then all the guys now who don't work, these guys are going to end up having to drop down or to just quit poker. But right now, as it stands, like these guys are just most, like 80% of them, they're just rufflers, you know, like complete rufflers, I'd say.
Tournament players are lazy, huh? Is that what you're saying?
Very, very. And I mean, yeah, very, very. I mean, and this is why Fido is the best in the world, because he made, like last year, he won the W Cup main event for $1 million, and he made a video on Reddit once last week of his video, and he played very bad in the video. He even said himself, like, what the fuck am I doing here? I played very bad. Like, why am I raising this hand? Why am I free betting this hand? Why am I folding this hand? So 1 year ago, he won $1 million, and he was, I'm not going to say he was bad because he was better than the other guys, but he wasn't close to playing amazing, you know? And then after he made $1 million, after most people make $1 million in poker, they lose it on live tournaments. They just go around spending the money. They become lazy. They don't want to work hard. But Fido did the opposite. He was like, wow, I've got $1 million. I want to make $5 million. So like, he was in the lab every day. He was studying, blah, blah, blah. And he used the money to his advantage. Like maybe he bought coaching. Maybe he did whatever with the money. And he wanted to be the best because of that. Do you know what I mean? So like, he's like kind of, a lot of the guys, they make $1 million, and it's like, how can I spend $1 million? Like, what can I do?
Yeah, everyone's making $1 million these days, Pads. You're right. It's a good point, Plano.
Or like, even 100,000. Like, a guy wins a Sunday million. Is he going to work hard for the next month, or is he going to, like, go for holidays and play, like, 25Ks in PCA, you know? Like, so many guys who are playing these 10Ks and 25K high rollers, they've just had a big bank, and they just want to spend their money. They want to run it up, you know? But, like, running it up, although it sounds very cool, and it's interesting, it's fun, and you can run it up, but most of the time it doesn't work, you know? Like most of the time you run it down. I mean, we have guys who apply for staking for my company. Like I get one guy a week who has made more than $500,000 playing poker, you know? And now they're broke. Every single week this happens. I mean, that shouldn't happen. You know, you make $500,000, you shouldn't need to give away 50% of your equity to someone, you know? That's how tournament poker works, you know? They have money and then they give it away somehow. Like, I heard a story today. I mean, I definitely can't say names for this one, but a guy was staking somebody and he wanted to propose to his girlfriend. So he says to the backer, he's like, look, I want to propose to the girlfriend. I love her, blah, blah, blah. I need to buy her a ring. Can I put the ring on makeup? So let's say he's in like 20K makeup. He loans 20,000 from the backer.
Fucking tournament players. Goddamn tournament players, man. Okay.
So he loans 20,000, but when you take a loan from a backer, you double it. So if you loan $10,000 to buy a ring, then you put 20,000 on makeup. It's confusing, but that's how it works. So he puts $20,000 on makeup to buy the ring, and then 2 weeks later, the guy drops him from the stable. So the guy basically buys the guy a wedding ring for like $20,000 for no reason, you know? And this is just how it happens in poker. There's so many irresponsible players, but also there's so many irresponsible backers too. Like I know Zimmer wrote to me yesterday on Twitter. Do you remember? Do you know Zimmer, this guy? You did a podcast with him, right?
I got my boy Zimmer on a podcast for sure. Yeah. Shout out to Zimmer.
He's a super nice guy. Like I like him a lot. I think he's a very, very nice guy. I respect him and stuff. But he was saying like, telling me that I'm going to get scammed one day, you know, like eventually I'll get scammed. I'm so lucky that I haven't been scammed yet. But I think a lot of people are happy to stake people that have made $600,000 and have a proven record in poker. But if someone's up $500,000 and they apply for staking, I think the guy is an idiot. I don't think he's clever, you know? I'd rather stake a guy who's up $50,000, who's like a 21-year-old student who has lots of promise and that I can turn into a sicko, you know? I wouldn't want some guy who's been playing like 10Ks all around the world and now he wants to play a $20 average buy-in for me on a Tuesday evening, because these guys are just looking to spin it up and spin it down, you know? And that's why I think we're not going to get scammed very often, because we take guys who have a lot of potential, who don't have money, who haven't had money, and then we teach them to get better, and then hopefully they're going to get money and be loyal to us, you know? That's how our business model is anyway.
Do you run the staking company? What, the name of the staking company is B. What's the name of the staking company?
I had a blog called when I was 18. I was like quite egotistical when I had no right to be. I had a blog called The Best in the Business. So like I called myself The Best in the Business. I wanted to be the best poker player in the world. Blah blah blah. So our staking company is called BitB. So it's Best in the Business Staking. You know, like okay. we feel like we're the best staking company in the world. We coach very high volume, and the players we have as coaches are, I think, the best tournament players in the world. Like, I know I get a lot of stick like that. I'm licking up Fido's ass and stuff like this, but I think it's quite clear he's the best poker player in the world. If I wanted to be staked, then I'd want to be staked by him, you know? We have other guys who are very good, who've all made more than $1 million. And also, like, most people who are staking, they don't play poker much anymore, you know? Like, this is their career, so they want to just be a poker staker, you know? So they can't coach the guys to get better, but we're playing every day too. So I think we're a good company. I think we do some stuff not so great. We're just a new company. We've only been around for like less than a year now. Because we all play so much, we don't manage our time very well. We forget things. We don't turn up sometimes. But we're actually trying to hire a CEO to work for us. For like, we're going to pay him like a salary and work 8 hours a day and make sure we don't get scammed and do our accounting and find us new players and run our website and stuff like that. Actually, I did get scammed once, and it was from somebody who made a website for us. So there's a guy in Budapest who said he was going to make a website for us. I went to his house. I gave him like €1,000. And then 2 weeks later, he told me, oh, yeah, it'll be ready in 2 weeks. 4 weeks later, he tells me two weeks. And then he just deletes me off Facebook and doesn't answer my calls. And he ended up scamming us for the money, but he's going to pay it back. But the only person we've been scammed by is the guy who made our website, which is quite ironic, I guess, considering the amount of people we deal with. So yeah.
Brendan D on YouTube. Shout out to my boy, Brendan D. What's up, Brent? I might be using the term my boy loosely, but Brent is a hardcore viewer of the podcast. Shout out to Brendan. He says, made more than $1 million or had cash is more than $1 million. Big difference.
Made more than $1 million. Yeah. Made more than $1 million. I mean, people know the guys. I mean, we're quite transparent with our results and stuff like this. So yeah.
Is he referring to people, the people who apply for staking that?
No, our coaches.
Oh, your coaches. Okay, so they've made allegedly more than $1 million, not more $1 million more in cashes.
Yeah, made more than $1 million. Yeah, like their profit. Everyone's profit this year is over $300,000. Like, we're regular players who are playing poker every week, and we're at the top, hopefully at the top of the game, or at least assume that we are. Mm-hmm. Or maybe we're
sure good. We got the people in the chat look interested and out. Broda says, who are the people in his eyes should be looking for backing?
Who should be looking for backing?
People in his eyes, yeah.
I mean, I don't think you should give away 50% of your equity to someone unless they can help you get money, you know? Like, giving away 50% of your money is just a very bad idea unless you have someone who can improve your EV. So let's say I go and get staked. Let's say you're a rich guy who plays PLO and I need an MTT stake. Like, it's not good for you to stake me because you can't increase my EV, right? Like, you're not going to coach me and spend 10 hours a week like helping me be a tournament player, right? But if I needed staking and I could write to Fido and he's going to coach me 10 hours a week and he's going to improve my EV, then it's not necessarily a negative thing to get staked, you know? But even for our guys who we stake, like, I think most of them should try to play by themselves eventually, you know, like, that's the end goal, I think. But yeah, hopefully we can teach them the stuff over like the first 2 years and then they can go on their own money. I mean, I've been staked a lot of times in my life too. I was staked by some Russian guys. I've been staked by numerous people, numerous different people, Canadians, PLO players, whoever else. I've not been shy to be getting staked before when I needed to play certain stakes. So
I got to give a shout out to your mom. She sent a message on Twitter. She said, Patrick's mom here. Great podcast. Shout out to Anne. Big shout out to her, man. Shout out to Patrick's mom watching the podcast, supporting.
So I have a game. Let's play a game. Okay.
You want to play a game with me?
Yeah. All right. So I say four things.
Okay.
You have to guess which one is true, three are false, and one is true. Okay.
Oh, we start playing this game, the two truths, one lie, but we don't do four, we do three. But okay, go ahead. So what's the game? I'll play the game with you. So it's four things. We say four things.
I say four things. One of them is true and three of them is false.
Okay, so you're gonna tell me four things. Three of them are false, one of them's true, allegedly.
Yeah. And the chat can play along too, I guess. All right. So number one, my dad is a world champion fisherman.
Okay.
Number two, my mom is a world champion Sudoku player.
Shout out to your mom, dude. She's a seducer.
Number three, I've never drank a hot drink in my life. And number four, I've never eaten French fries before in my life.
Well, you just said you go to KFC and get a goddamn thing with French fries. You just said that towards the beginning of the podcast, right? So it's three lies and one truth, right?
Yeah, it's one's true.
So you either lied at the beginning of the podcast to me, which I'm hurt now that you fucking lied to me.
No, fries is false. So there's two more which is false and one of them which is true.
Wait, you said when you go to KFC, you get a big meal thing with fries.
So this is one lie and there's two more lies, right?
No, you told me you did that. That's the truth.
Yes. I've never eaten fries in my life.
Sorry, I took it.
My dad's a world champion fisherman.
Okay.
My mom's a world champion Sudoku player.
Okay.
Number three, I've never drank a hot drink in my life. And number four, I've never eaten French fries in my life.
So when you use don't, like, it just it throws it off in my mind here. So the mom's a Sudoku.
No. I've never drank a hot drink before.
Yeah, I was just hoping it was the Sudoku one. Yeah, so you've never drinking a hot drink before in your life, like ever.
I seriously think I'm the most pickiest eater in the world. Poker player. I mean, like, the top 1% for sure. Maybe I'm the most pickiest guy. I have one more, just last one, okay? This one is about number one, I think women are significantly inferior to men at poker.
Oh my God, don't know. I am not getting a feminist on this fucking podcast.
Number two, I think anybody that is religious is significantly dumber than someone who is an atheist.
Fucking Christ, man.
Number three, I think Daniel Negreanu is the biggest scumbag in poker.
Wait a sec. One of these you actually think, right?
Yeah.
Okay.
And number four, I don't believe any of the above.
What kind of weird games are these, man? Okay, so
you want to say again?
The first one, I'm not repeating. I'm gonna get them. They're gonna get upset at me. I'm gonna get Twittered and Kate Hall. I don't want Kate Hall in my mentions right now. I mean, I like Kate Hall. I want her in my mentions, but I don't want her in my mentions for that number first statement you said. So I'm gonna go with all of the above are false. D.
Yeah, good. I didn't think you would go for D, but. I thought you went for Negreanu because I was like tweeting at him about poker stars and stuff like this.
No, you don't think Negreanu is this. No, what has Negreanu done that would be scum? He's not a scum. Come on, he might be a little. Supports poker star. He's not a scumbag though. For anything.
Yeah, I mean, my views on poker stars kind of. When I was working for Poker Strategy, we sold our company to iPoker. So iPoker bought us for 49 million euros. So I was like part of the process where we. Sold the company and stuff like this. And one of the things when you sell a company to somebody is this is how you can make money out of our company. Do you know what I mean? So like the way that PokerStars would have presented it to Amir and all of these guys, they would have like said all the different ways how Amir can make money. And most of these things would be ways which would fuck regular players, you know? So like it didn't matter who bought PokerStars. They were all going to do the stuff that PokerStars suggested to them to do. Do you know what I mean? Because PokerStars would have thought of all these clever ways to kind of fuck the players to make the most money for the company, you know? So, like, all these stuff that Amir is doing, it's not really Amir who's doing it. It's PokerStars who are doing it. The only reason why Amir are very coming off bad is because they have terrible PR. They say it in a terrible way. They don't have any good positive stuff, you know? So Amir is just, like, a stupid company, I'd say, like, but I don't think they're like an evil company. I think that any company would have done the same because that's the way that stars would have suggested to do it. But I don't think they're evil. I just think they're like stupid and they're not very professional in the way they do everything.
Wasn't the narrative that Amaya approached PokerStars about purchasing the company and offered this exorbitant price to them and that was why they sold it? But you're saying that it might actually have been PokerStars was going to sell it and Amaya, if they own OnGame and they're...
PokerStars kind of... their whole thing of poker, their whole business plan was to get on regular side, right? Like their customer service was better than any other company. They bought Full Tilt to appease all the players. They did this, and this to please everybody. But as Negreanu said, they were making these changes. They knew they had to make these changes. So their whole business plan of being on regular side and having this player to company kind of relationship, this was always going to change. So they knew that they were going to end up losing customers, whatever, and it's probably going to be best for them to sell their company. But the thing that Granu said, which was very flawed, he said, he said recreational poker players are losing 20% faster than anywhere else, right? Like, than they were last year. He said, poker players are losing deposits 20% faster than they were in 2014. But, and he said they deposit $20 on average, right? So he said they deposit $20 and they lose it 20% faster than previously. So let's think of how they put the money in, right? They put $20 in it. Let's say they want to play PLO 10. And so my mom deposits $20 and plays PLO 10. Shout out to Anne. And
a PLO player?
No. But if she did, let's say she did. Let's say she deposited $20 to play PLO 10. The rake is 13 big blinds per 100, right? So there's no way she can win. She's going to get eaten up by the rake straight away.
Right.
So if PokerStars want people's deposits to last longer in microstakes, there's no reason to start changing SNE and all this kind of stuff, because these people aren't depositing $20 and playing NL 1000, like 5-10. You don't need to punish these guys. Like, if the main thing behind this is helping depositing players playing microstakes and you want them to stick around for longer and have a better experience, then you just lower the micro rake so that the BB per 100 naturally just increases and then they're going to last longer, you know? Like, all of these changes are not affecting NL 10, PLO 10, PLO 20, where the games are unbeatable. And Negroni says, yeah, we need to change this because the depositing players are losing their money 20% quicker and depositing $20 and losing it after 52 hands instead of 106 hands, whatever else, you know? Like, he doesn't understand that anything, this is happening because the rake is so fucking high, you know? And like, the game's unbeatable, so obviously they're not going to last very long, you know? So, like, I wouldn't last long. You wouldn't. Well, maybe you would because you're the boss. But if you played like PLO 20 with like 30 big blind rake, you know, like, which is like the equivalent of a recreational guy playing with 10 big blind rake, then you wouldn't last that long. You'd just get eaten up by the rake, right?
Hmm. Yeah, that's a good point. I mean, that's definitely a point I haven't heard somebody make. And that seems to be the narrative from the PokerStars side, is that, oh, things got to change. I mean, things got to change. In theory, they should lower the rake at these stakes where these, as you said, the amateurs are depositing $20 and then going to player. Now they're playing spin and goes where you put in $10 and for three players, the prize pool is $20. Like, it.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. That's like such a good point. Either a guy's going to make a fucking million or he's going to lose his money, you know? Like, that's how like these spin and goes are. Like, you either win a lot of money or you lose your money quickly, you know? Like, this is how spin and goes work, because you put in $5 each and three guys and the prize pool is $10. Obviously, you're going to lose your money at a quick rate or you're going to win a lot of money, you know?
And I couldn't believe it. I was watching a stream and they did a spin and goes at $20 and the prize pool said 40. I was like, what the fuck do they mean 40? Sorry, yeah. Shot. Someone said, no, I'm not. I swear sometimes in the shot, I apologize to your mom in advance. But I was like, are they? So wait a sec. It's $20 and you can only win $40 in this situation. I just couldn't believe that was how these spin and goes are set up. And this is like their main thing they're advertising. It just seems.
And you know what tilts me the most is this whole like money that they're fucking plowing into, the money that they're plowing into these sports stars. Like, the money they give these guys is incredible. Like, they're giving Neymar probably like millions, Ronaldo millions, Nadal millions. And these guys don't even want to be ambassadors. Like, have you ever seen Rafa Nadal wearing a PokerStars hoodie at a tennis match? Or have you ever seen Ronaldo wearing a PokerStars patch on his jacket when he's going to a football match? Like, the people who watch these guys in public, they don't see the guy being an ambassador. The only times they see them wearing a patch is when they turn up for a live tournament. And Cristiano Ronaldo doesn't play live tournaments. Neymar's played one for like 20 minutes. And Nadal didn't ever come. Like, people don't see these guys. And they're taking like millions and millions out of the economy, poker economy, to do this. Like, taking like 12 million, like, let's say they do this for 3 years and they pay the guys like $3 million each. That's like $30 million almost. I mean, and I don't think they're bringing in deposits worth $30 million for these guys, you know? Like, I just think it's ridiculous how much money, how poorly they're executing these marketing plans. I mean, Ronaldo has no interest at all for being a PokerStars ambassador. He doesn't care. He's probably never played poker before. He doesn't ever come, he doesn't go to like EBT Barcelona or anything like this, you know? Like, he has no incentive at all, and he still gets the money every month into his paycheck, you know? Like, I feel like taking over $20 million and putting it into here is definitely not the right thing you want to do. What good marketing is if somebody, like, let's say my friends know I'm a successful poker player, that's good, right? People say, oh, like, I have friends in Budapest who make, like, 10 or 15,000 a year, who they're like, oh, I want to be a poker player too, you know? So I tell them, okay, right, deposit in PokerStars, put your $20 in. So they put their $20 in, and it's impossible to make money. Like, you don't get any more guys who are going through the stakes and becoming high stakes guys. Like, if you look at the guys who play NL 1K plus, all of these guys have been professional poker players for years and years. In the past, it didn't used to be like this. Like, guys used to spin up from NL 5 to like NL 1K in like a few months. Like, this is what happened. There's so many guys like this. But now, because it's unbeatable, like, even if you went down to NL 5 with like a $50 bankroll, you couldn't get up to NL 1K. You know, like, it just, it's almost impossible, I think. I think the rake is unbeatable. So there's not as many guys who are like breaking out to being professional poker players and like inspiring other players. Like, if they spent this $30 million on lowering the rake in PLO or in Hold'em or whatever else they want to lower it in, and have more success stories coming out, seeing people driving around a Porsche that they spent on VBPs, stuff like this makes other people want to play poker. Having Cristiano Ronaldo like post an Instagram picture once every 2 or 3 months, I mean, it just, I don't think this money is like well spent, you know? I'm not sure who's doing the marketing of PokerStars. I don't know. I think it's very, very poorly executed by PokerStars in general. And I think it's a bit of a joke that they're going to be taking this much money out of the poker economy, and when they could be investing it on other kind of stuff, you know. I just don't think it's good. Like, they're so scared in MTTs to have like, if they have $100 overlay in a tournament, they like decrease the prize pool by like 5,000 and like go absolutely crazy. They have internal meetings about how like this is the end, it's a disaster, we have to cancel this tournament. But then they're prepared to spend like 40 million on 30 million or whatever the number is on all these like silly sports star marketing. I think it's a joke. Like, I don't think many people are playing poker because of Cristiano Ronaldo, you know.
Yeah, I wonder if they have some sort of way that they can quantify the value that having these sports stars is bringing to them. I mean, I'd be curious. I mean, obviously, we're probably never going to know the answer to this question. Maybe in like 20 years, when I get David Bazoff on the podcast after he's gets fired. No, knock on wood, my boy David. I know you're out there listening, but if he gets funny, gets fired from Amaya and he's on like the prowl and he's at a new company in 20 years and he comes on the podcast. But maybe then we're going to get the answers. And if we do, I want to come back to this moment in time with Patrick at 1 hour in, and I want to timestamp this, and I want this to come up.
I used to be a consultant for like poker companies. Like, we used to try to give them our opinion of how they should improve their site. And let's say like a site like William Hill, you know William Hill or not?
I'm familiar with it. Yeah.
It's like a big sports book. So they have a poker skin, and basically like they have shareholders in the company, right? So the shareholders, all they care about is rake generated. So like, if this amount of money was generated through poker in January, then in February they don't want it to drop down, right? So the poker sites used to get to the end of the month, like 20th of the month, and they used to look at how much rake they had in their targets. And if they weren't matching their targets, they would go to the biggest guys on iPoker, and they would give them 150% rake back and say, you can have 150% rake back if you rake 10K in the next 5 days, whatever. So they would basically purposely lose money just so shareholders wouldn't be scared that poker was going down, because they don't want anything to go down in their business. They want poker to go up. They want sports book to go up. They want casino to go up. So they were running their business like not even, they were trying to lose money so that people wouldn't try to sell their shares and shares would go down, you know. Like, most of these companies were just like, I think Victor Chandler were just like paying like absurd amount of money to players to play on their side. Like, you could regularly get 150% rake back. I mean, you're just printing money. I mean, and the poker manager who is getting paid like $2,000 a month or something, he's basically losing the company like $50,000 because he wants to make sure the numbers look good on a spreadsheet. You know, like, it's all like, there's so much politics within like internally where people are spending money and stuff like this. Like, we would give them like pretty good ideas about how they could do stuff to like improve their site. And they were like, yeah, but we're not going to make money in the next month because of it. So we're not interested, you know, like, a lot of people in poker have very short-sighted way of thinking, I think. And
is this allegedly, or this actually happened? People were.
This happened for sure. It's happened for sure. 100%. Yeah.
Wow.
I think it was Victor Chandler. I don't know if it was William Hill. There was like 3 sites, like Mansion or something, and Victor Chandler and someone else. They would, all this kind of stuff. There was so much dodgy stuff going on. Like.
Wow. I gotta give a shout out to. So. There is the craziest person I know in the world that follows me on Twitter. Shout out to my boy Juice at Rector444. Rexter is watching the podcast. He always tweets me all this crazy shit about ideal poker and the rake. And if you haven't been lucky enough to get a tweet from this guy, you got to get a tweet from this guy. I love this guy. I don't know what the fuck he's talking about half the time, but he sends me like 15 tweets at once. And I try reading it, but I honestly just give up sometimes. But he says, Patrick knows his shit. 100% agree with his narrative and his economics. he will understand ideal poker. So I just want to give him a shout out. So I keep getting crazy messages from him. He is the craziest person I know on Twitter. So thank you, sir, for being insane. We have an interesting comment on YouTube from Bling Blau. He says, any comments on the accusations of you joining Pokar? I'm not sure what that is, which is a well-known staking stable. Now I know, only to steal their business model and contracts.
Yeah, I mean, we have very, very different business models. Pokar's business model is, I mean, I don't want to bash Pokar. Pokar are my friends. I respect them.
What's he talking about? I don't know anything about this.
I joined Pokar, which was a stable, and I had bought into the stable, like 5% of the stable or whatever it was. And then I left after like a month or 2 months after. It just didn't work out for whatever reasons. But we didn't pinch their staking stable or anything like that. We didn't pinch their business model. I mean, all their guys are playing like low stakes and they don't really have, I don't want to bash them up. I mean, I have a lot of love for Pokar. Their business model is amazing. What they do is very good. They make a lot of money, but our business model is very different. Like, I want to stake the top 100 guys in the world who are staked. I want to stake, you know, and I want to make them to be the top 100 guys. Like, that's like my dream my goal is to get the 100 guys who are the best in the world who are staked. I want to stake them. Pokar's goal is very different to that, you know. So yeah, I mean, I don't want to bash them. I don't want to bash them. I like them a lot. I have very good things to say about them. So yeah, no bad words about Pokar. But I will disagree with the guy's comments.
So it sounds like they think that you came out of the stable for a month and then you took off and you sort of incorporated some of their ideals or their themes into your own thing. But that's not what happened though.
Yeah, I mean, a couple of their guys left their stable and joined my stable, which I didn't ask them to. They just decided to leave because they had...
So that could be something where they see it some other type of way.
Yeah, and Pokar definitely do a lot of things better than what we do. And I think we do a lot of things better than what they do. And I think a good way of working together, we could work together, I think. I mean, we're speaking with some Russian guys right now trying to work together, but I think stables should work closer together, you know, like... If there's a small stakes guys and we're higher stakes, then we could give them guys who apply to us who don't meet our standards, and they could give guys who are wanting to play higher stakes than what they allow. I mean, there's definitely ways we could work together. I think in the future, Pokar and our stable will work together, and I hope they do. Maybe they don't want to, but I would hope that together we can work together perhaps. And I have nothing bad to say about them. Oh, I don't want to say anything bad about them.
Tosfinos on Twitch says, do you think the best 100 people in the world need staking? So what you're saying is you want to stake the 100 best people that are going to get staking, not the 100 best players in the world, correct?
Yeah, exactly. The 100 guys who want to be staked. I think, I mean, and this is me being very arrogant and stuff like this, but I think if you're staked, there's no reason to not be staked by my company, you know? So I think like after people hear like word of mouth, like a lot of guys have joined us because their friends play for us and they say, yeah, you should join these guys, you know? And I mean, it sounds arrogant or whatever, but I think if you were staked by a different company, then you should have probably applied for our company. But we're not going to go out and tell people this, you know? So we're never going to go and poach people off other guys.
I don't know about this dynamic. So what you're saying is that there are multiple different staking companies for these tournament players. And in a way, it's like the companies are competing for the best players. So as a player, if you're a potential GTO selection, then you have options to shop around with these different corporations or different companies, it sounds like.
Yeah, exactly, yeah. And you can negotiate different deals, and like some companies may give you like 60-40, some companies may give you 50-50, some companies may give you coaching, some companies may not give you coaching, some guys may let you play live tournaments, some guys may not, all this kind of stuff, you know.
Interesting, so there's like this little subculture of these staking companies. You know, I think... my buddy Holdick got in touch. He was talking about something that he was involved in too. I don't know when he brought it up to me. I didn't know what he was talking. I was like, I don't know anything about these staking companies.
He manages BBZ's small stake stable. That's like BBZ. Do you know him? BBZ. He's quite a known guy.
I wasn't familiar with him. He mentioned his name as well. I'm not super familiar with the guy.
He like owns this big staking company, and he has a small stakes staking company, which hold it runs for him. Like, so guys who play like $10 tournaments and stuff, and then hold it runs this part of his company for him and runs it. I think he does a good job. I met him in Monaco, I think, somewhere, and he seemed like a nice guy. Seemed like a good guy.
Okay, shout out to Holden, man. So yeah, it's like, how many companies are there? Are there a lot of, is it a...
There's three main ones. No, there's four main ones. There's Dimitri. Do you know Dimitri? Dimitri is like this super aggro guy who, like, if you piss him off, he's just like fucking going crazy. You're like, he's like threatening you and stuff like this.
Tournament player, right?
And he gives very good deals. He gives like 80-20 deals, you know, but no, I don't think he goes coaching or anything like this. He's given like the amazing deals, but like he gets a lot of bad fresh because he's like threatening people and stuff. But I think he seems like a fun guy. I don't know. Then you have Pokal, who do small stakes. Then you have BBZ, who do small and mid stakes and high stakes. And then you have Power Stable. There's some other small ones, but they only have like whatever. They're like the four main ones, I would guess. But yeah, I mean, it's quite fun. I mean, it's like, I don't know. I mean, it's fun.
It's like its own game in itself, huh?
The thing is, in tournaments, everyone is staked, you know? Like, everybody staked who plays tournaments. Like, there's like very few people who play tournaments who are not staked because tournament players are so poor at managing their money in general.
Right.
They just, yeah, because they have no money for like 6 months and then they win a tournament for 20K and then they have this 20K. Usually, like, they haven't had fun. If you haven't had fun for 6 months, then you have $20,000 and you've worked really hard. You want to have fun, you know? Like, you have fun, you go on holiday, you go to Vegas, whatever, you know? And then afterwards, you have no money left, and then you don't win for 6 months, and then that's just kind of how their life is, which is kind of sad.
It's so, you know, honestly, it's so weird hearing this stuff because I've been very entrenched in the PLO world, high stakes PLO world for a while, and like this, I mean, I know a couple of degenerates who are some people, you know, might think they're not staked, and they are staked for games or play, but like this isn't the way most successful cash game players really approach poker life or their own situation. They don't approach like they don't win 20K and like, all right, I'm gonna take time off. They win 20K and then they play the next 18 months straight and win 20K every month or something like that. Like, it's just
no cash game players get staked, you know? Like, there's no successful cash game players who are staked because they're sensible, you know? Like, you never, I don't know, I've got a lot of friends who play cash games and no one is staked. Like, I couldn't name one guy who's staked who plays cash games, or like very few, because just especially because your win rate and like, let's say you get staked for 400 now. Your win rate at 200 now is going to be, you only get 50% of the money, right? So let's say you win 10K at 4K now, or you could win 5K at 2K now, at 200 now, sorry. Then you may as well play 200 now on your own money then, because it's going to be softer than 400 is, and you get 50% of the money. Does that make sense?
Okay, where I found that makes sense though, from some standpoint, it depends if you're getting coaching. I think if you're getting coaching there, it changes things a little bit.
Yeah.
But I think where it changes is when you start wanting to play 5,100 or 100-200. So there's some players I know who are staked for those games they play, and they play big live too. So they're staked for these big live games. They're staked for the high stakes online games, and they sometimes might play staked. So I think that in a situation, then it changes. Not if you're like a 2-5, a Zoom player, and you want to maybe take a shot at 10-20, some of the regular tables or Zoom when it runs. Like, then you probably don't need a stake for that. But I guess when you start playing really high stakes, then you might want to consider getting a stake.
Yeah. I mean, I'm talking about like, I mean, like if you talk about tournament guys, like the guys who you can compare tournament guys with are like 200 NL or 400 NL grinders. I'm not talking about like 5K NL.
Okay. That makes sense.
But you could compare those with like guys who are playing these like super high rollers and stuff like this. Like, there's some guys who are playing these super high rollers who have 1% of themselves or 2% of themselves.
Oh, that's yeah.
They fly to Monaco. They spend money on hotels, and then they play for 2% of themselves. I mean, it's just very egotistical, I think, just playing, because you're spending more money on getting there and spending money on sandwiches and stuff in Monaco than you are on your EV of how much money you're going to make, you know? So being a live tournament player, I don't think is the way forward for many people.
Zima's in the chat. Zima says, didn't realize Elio and I don't stake anyone anymore. News to me. You didn't, I don't know if you set his staking stable in the...
I mean, they don't, yeah. Zima and Elio, like, they're like the old school, I think. They've been staking for like years and years, and they like, they have different, they do different deals than a lot of people. They're like, yeah. I think a lot of people, like high stakes guys, when they go broke, they write to Elio and Zima because they have very good reputation. Like, you know, you can trust Zima and Elio, and they do like shorter stuff, I think, stuff like this. Like, they're good guys to get staked by, especially if you want to play like highest, like very high stakes. Like, in my stable, we don't stake guys as high as Elio and Zima too, because variance is very big. It's hard to sleep at night and stuff like this when you have a guy who's in 200K makeup. You start hating the guy as well. Like, if you have a guy who's lost $200,000 for you, you just start not liking him, or like, you start not liking him, but you start finding the stuff about him that you don't like. Do you know what I mean? Like when a guy's made you $100,000, you're like, papi, you know, like give us some love, you know, like you go on holiday with him. But when a guy's lost you
$100,000,
when a guy's lost you $100,000, you're not always like asking him if he wants to go for dinner and stuff, you know.
Like papi, what's up? How's it going? Yeah. You want to be better lately?
Or why you're not grinding or something like this, you know? Like I know I've had friends who've been staking people and they've had like they've been living with the guys that have been staking, and they've had like the guys who've just been not paying attention when they've been playing, and it's hurt their like friendship too, you know, because they've been playing, like they're on Facebook whilst they're playing and they're not paying attention and stuff like that.
That tilts me right now. Daniel says in chat, cool to see Plano 8 on here. He's one of my first poker heroes.
Who?
Show of force, Daniel. Shout out to Daniel, by the way. So you mentioned tournament players playing with 2% of themselves. Do you play in these super high rollers? Do you play in any of these things?
Well, I kind of had this. I was very against them. And last year I did pretty well in tournaments. I only started playing tournaments last year, like mid March last year. I was playing cash games before. And
wait a sec. So you were a cash game player only previous to that?
For the last 8 years until last year, yeah. I only played cash games. I was in playing tournaments from March last year.
Your screen name's what is it?
I was playing on microgaming mostly, like non-stop.
Oh, so you didn't play a lot in stars on the pads 1161 count.
I played some on stars, yeah. I played some on stars. Mostly I was playing like microgaming and like European with like 150% rake back, you know, like this kind of stuff. The high deals.
Of course.
It was the GTO way to do it, I guess.
They're fucking 150% rake back. Sounds pretty good, yeah.
Yeah, so anyway, last year I started playing tournaments, and I said to my friend Monster Dong, you know Monster Dong?
Heard of the name, but I've heard of it. I don't, like the tournament players I know are Fedor, Pratush.
Yeah. Raccoon. Where's Pratush? Where is he these days?
BLP?
He's not on Twitter, he's not in live tournaments. Where is he?
He's probably going to tell you he's in the lab.
He's in the lab, yeah, maybe he's in the lab. Yeah.
His nickname's PLP, so what do you think he's doing with his time right now?
That's true. So anyway, these live tournaments I always thought were egotistical and stuff, but it came to March or something, April this year, and I set myself these goals of Monte Carlo, WSOP, and Scoop. Like I really wanted to do well in these stuff. Like I set myself goals. Like I wanted to final table 2 events in EBT. I wanted to win a WSOP bracelet. I wanted to win a Scoop event. And Monaco Scoop, I think, was first, and I didn't do well. And I started feeling kind of like sad about it. I didn't feel like I reached my expectations and my potential and stuff like this. I went to Monaco and I played 25K. And the very last hand of I was very happy at the end of the day because my blog at this time was I made a blog at this time writing about this is when I started the blog. Mm-hmm. And I went to Monaco, and at the end of the day, I was going to be like top 5 in chips in the 25K. And this was the first time I'd ever played a high roller. So I was really proud to like go on to 2+2 on my blog and like tell everybody that I was in the top 5 chips in the 25K and blah, blah, blah. And the last hand of the day, I looked down at Kings. And anyway, long story short, I lose against Dan Smith on the river in some stupid pot. And I remember walking back to my hotel room in Monaco. And this was the first time that in poker I've ever felt sad. Like I genuinely, like this wasn't tilted or I wasn't angry. I wasn't angry at Dan Smith. I wasn't sad. I wasn't tilted that I lost the pot. I was just genuinely sad. Like poker for the first time had made me sad. And I felt very like, I was sitting in my hotel room by myself, just not feeling like, as in Monte Carlo, like so many different people are like all over the world grinding, whatever. I'm in Monte Carlo and I'm like feeling sorry for myself, which I definitely shouldn't have been. So anyway, go back to Vegas in a few months later, the next month, and I play a hand in a 10K 6-max. Like I bust out all the 5Ks, like getting unlucky. And then I played the 10K 6-max and I get unlucky in this tournament and I go back to my hotel room in Panorama Towers, you know Panorama?
Mm-hmm.
It's like a nice place to be in Vegas and stuff like this. And I wrote a blog, like I said, I like to be quite honest. And I was like saying I was feeling very depressed about poker. Like the last 3 months, I'd set myself up with these goals, expectations that I was going to make like $1 million and I was going to win a bracelet and all this kind of stuff. And I felt like kind of, I wanted to be like recognized by everyone as like the best poker player in the world. And I had all these, like, for some reason, I just had these expectations. And then because I hadn't lived up to the expectations, I felt inside that I was very depressed. But if I say to you now, like, what is depression? What would you say? Like, what would you say depressed is?
What is depressed?
What is depression? Like, what would you say depression was if you just had to say it? Like, what would you say being depressed is?
Maybe feeling sad, feeling worthless, feeling like you have these goals or dreams and you're not getting anywhere close to them. You just keep failing and you keep trying, you keep failing. You're not reaching expectations.
So exactly how I felt. Like, I'm not like anywhere near like a mental health kind of expert or anything, but I was sitting in my room in Vegas and I wasn't tilted. Like, when people lose tournaments, they go smash the football, go get drunk or go like do whatever with women. I don't know. But I was just genuinely very sad. Like, I was just depressed that I hadn't done better than I'd done. And it wasn't really in my hands, because in tournament poker, it's not in your hands, you know? So for the first time ever in poker, I was sad. And I was like doubting if I wanted to do this anymore. And then I wrote my blog about it and everyone was like, fucking man up, you know, like, you've just won like 500,000 in the last 12 months. Don't be fucking greedy, stuff like this, which is very reasonable. And I just realized that I had to start like thinking about poker very differently. Like, now I have goals. Like, my goal is to win a WSOP bracelet. But my expectations is what I'm going to be happy or sad about. So, like, my expectations is when I go to Vegas next year that I don't sleep for 5 hours a night, that I have proper sleep, that I eat well, that I go to the gym. And as long as I meet my expectations, I'm very happy. So, like, I went to Malta last week and I played at 10K and I lost, like, 50,000 euros in Malta or whatever playing poker. And I was very, very fine about it. I wasn't sad. I wasn't depressed at all, because all my expectations were kind of out there. Like, I met all my expectations and I can't kind of handle my goals. Does that make sense or not? So I was scared to play like high rollers at one point in the year because I was scared to fail and I was scared for people to think, oh yeah, this guy's trying to play too high stakes and he's not good enough to do it. And I was scared. I was like almost scared and like depressed that people were feeling like that. But now, like, I just don't care. As long as I feel like personally that I played well and all that stuff, I'm not going to feel depressed or sad about it. Do you know what I mean? But I think in poker, a lot of people feel very lonely, very sad, very like they don't have money, you know, like they work hard and they don't have money to pay rent, or they have to make $2,000 in the next month. Otherwise, they can't pay their kids' tuition or something like this. Like, poker's a place where you can feel sad and lonely very quickly. And I think it's hard to deal with, you know, like the downsides of poker are nowhere near as good as the ups are, you know. That's why I feel poker is a very tough game, especially in tournaments. And with our guys, we use like mental coaches and stuff like this, because I think mental game is like more important than probably anything in poker, I would say. So yeah, for these high rollers now, I'm happy to play them because I feel okay. If I bust, I don't feel sad anymore. But if I'm playing poker and it's making me sad, then I think I should stop and think about if I should play poker or not. Do you know what I mean? Or get myself to a mental state where I'm not going to feel sad if I lose, because 99% of the time I'm not going to win, you know, like I'm not going to win the tournament, you know, I'm only going to win the tournament like 1% of the time. So if that makes me sad, then I should probably think about a different career or something, I guess, if I can't work it out.
I wonder if cash game players ever get sad, because it's like, it's just such a different environment. You know what I mean? Like, you don't really... Like, when you're a winning cash game player, you have a bankroll, you're playing medium stakes, high stakes, whatever. Like, it's pretty consistent in a way. Obviously, you can lose a lot of money, you go on big downswings at high stakes, but for the most part, it's pretty consistent. So you never really get these feelings where you play tournaments and you play like a 500K or a 100K and you lose, play 100K, you lose, play 50K, you lose. Like, you don't really go through stretches like this. You go through downswings, but when you have confidence in your game and know you're playing well, like, you always get past that. Like, you can always go back on that. You don't really get sad unless you're in like a, you know, like countdown to bust sort of state. And it seems like in tournaments, a lot of these players, you know, maybe don't have a lot of own personal money. So they're always on a stake and they're always in makeup. And it just seems like a much more depressing part of poker to be in. You mentioned poker can be sad. And I feel like at cash games, you don't necessarily experience the sadness because it's just like such a, I guess the day-to-day is different. The mindset's different. The approach is different. And I just, I haven't really thought about this perspective of things the way you're saying it. So it's interesting to me to hear.
And at the peak of this sadness, however, there was a 10K PLO, which I ended up coming like 15th in or something. And I was started the day. Do you know Anthony Zeno, this guy, American guy?
Mm-hmm. Running pretty well.
I played against him, and for the whole of the first day, he was saying very nice things, like he thought I was playing really well, blah, 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 and like I had this very good player who was like recognizing me for playing well, so I felt very good, you know. I was like, oh, all right, okay, playing, I got four cards, it's a little bit easier now, you know, I can do some more stuff. And then I got moved to a table with Stealth Monk and Jared Blesnick, you know, this Jared Blesnick guy, Harrington 25 and all this other stuff.
I might know who he is, yeah.
So we get to the table, and he's fucking just shouting and doing crazy stuff. I'm like, who the fuck's this guy? And I play a pot, and some guy goes all in on the river, and I'm playing PLO. I'm very uncomfortable playing PLO. I don't understand it all, you know? Like, I'm trying to work it out when I'm playing. And I start tanking for like 20 seconds, and Jared Blesnick, this is my first time I play a table. Jared Blesnick stands up, like slams his hand down on the table. He's like, fuck's sake, how long do we have to wait for? This was for like a huge pot, like 100 big blind pot or something. I'm like looking at him like, what the fuck? I was like totally surprised. And then he called the clock, and I'm like, what? So anyway, I end up calling against this guy. This guy was bluffing with the best hand. And then Jared Blesnick is like standing up, pointing at me like this, like laughing at me like, oh my God, that's the worst call I've ever seen, blah, blah. And I'm like, oh my God, like maybe that was terrible, I don't know. So like a minute later, the same guy puts me all in for my tournament life. I think for like 10 seconds, and now Blesnick stands up and he's like screaming around the room, like super animated. And I'm like, what the fuck, you know? I had like two pair on like a pair board or something. Like a board was like king 10, 8, 8, 4, I had king 10. And this guy puts me all in, and I'm like tanking, and then he calls the clock after like 20, 30 seconds. Eventually I call and I win. And Blesnick ends up like bluffing it all off to me in like a chip lead pot, and then he starts getting like super aggro, like and then I was looking around, and in this PLO tournament, I don't know anyone. All I could see was like unknown Scandies, like these random good looking guys from Sweden who I fucking have no idea who they were. Like I was looking around for like tournament guys who I could go and like berate this Blesnick guy about, but he was like just really going super aggro on me, and he was saying stuff like, it was pretty funny, like he had like 4,000 chips left and I had like 200,000 chips. And he said something like, the funny thing is that I have more of a chance of winning this tournament than you do, you know? And when I had like 50,000 more chips than him or something like this. And I said something out loud, like, I'd rather be bad than be like a scummer or something, or like a scammer or something like this. And then this just sent him like completely crazy. Like he started standing up and like, these like New York guys came to the table who looked like someone like from a mob movie or something like this. He was like, yo, Tommy, this guy's calling me a fucking scammer. What should we do? You know, I was like, oh God. And then Sean Deeb moved to the table, you know, Sean Deeb, obviously.
Shot, yeah.
And he started like sticking up for me and saying like, being more on my side and stuff like this. But this guy is just like complete idiot. And then, you know, Connor Drinan, this guy?
Yeah, I know Connor, yeah.
He came up to the table and he was like, he went to shake, he was really drunk. He went to shake Blesnick's hand, and Blesnick shakes his hand, and then Connor just like squeezes onto Blesnick's hand and doesn't let go. And he's like, I just want to let you know you're the biggest fucking scumbag in poker, blah, 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 and all this stuff. And Blesnick was like really shook up about it, you know? And I'm just sitting here at the table, like texting my friends on Facebook, like, guys, you've got no idea what's going on here. This guy's going crazy, and now this other guy's come over and whatever, you know? I think like Blesnick got evicted from the tournament, and then he had to ask the police to like help him get back to his hotel or something, because he's like scared that like Connor was going to kill him or something in the car park. I'm not sure, but that was very uncomfortable. And I think in general, a lot of the other people had really bad experiences with him at the tables too. Like I think does he have a disorder or something or what? I don't know.
I'm not sure.
I think he has like personality problem or something. I don't know. Like,
was there any chance during this tournament, did he tell you he thought you were the most aggressive player at the table?
No, I know the joke, but yeah.
Patrick.
Yeah.
You're the most aggressive player at this table.
Yeah. And what does Antonio say? He says something like, yeah, but I'm losing or something like this, right? It doesn't matter if I'm losing or
something like this. So wait, I think I saw a photo of you took a photo of him busting out. He busted out of the tournament. You took a photo of it?
The biggest huge pot. Well, the thing was, he was being very nasty to the fish. There was a fish from Monaco there who was playing like, it's funny how the fish opens, I free bet the fish, like ace, king, queen, jack, double suited. Fish calls, the flop is like 9-9-4,
The fun player opened. Okay. Right. Fun player.
You check it down to the river, and the fun player has 8, 8, 8, 8 in his hand. 4 8s, you know, plenty of 8 in a free bet pot. I free bet him, and he has his hand. So like once we get the showdown and he wins and I muck, this just sends Blesnik crazy, you know? Like Blesnik's like, oh my God, this is a fucking $10,000 tournament. And then like the tournament director came over and he was like saying to the tournament director, I'll pay you $20,000 now if you promise me that I won't get moved from this table tonight. And then his friend got moved to my left. I was on the left of the fun player. And then Blesnik was like standing up with his hand in his head. He's like, oh my God, I can't believe you have the best seat in the whole room. It's unbelievable. Like you're in the position of the fish. And the fun player was like very uncomfortable at this point. And Blesnik was being very nasty towards him. And like and the fun player whispered in my ear, he was like, I feel very uncomfortable. He was like, I really don't enjoy this at all. Like I'm feeling very bad about the whole experience, you know? It was not nice. It was fucking bad. Yeah. So anyway, I bust Blesnik in this huge pot. I don't do this. But I stood up and went like boom, something like this. And I got my phone out and then took a picture of him with his hand on his head like this and all his chips getting pushed to me. And then I made it like my Facebook profile picture for like 2 months or something like this. It was definitely like my best moment in poker, like my favorite, my most memorable moment anyway in poker.
When was this? 2014 or 15?
No, like three months ago.
Three months ago. So this was this summer.
Yeah, this was just a few months ago. Like it was like the last, it was like a week before the main night. It was when EDC was on, I think, or around about that time.
Oh yeah, the 10K. It was the 10K PLO, right?
10K PLO. Yeah, I think that was
Tuesday after EDC or Monday after EDC. I played in that. No, I didn't play in that one. That was the 3K PLO. My bad. The 10K was the week after EDC.
And then they had a 25K. Like,
that was on the Monday, correct? Yeah.
I didn't play that. I didn't feel comfortable flicking that one in.
What was Stealth Monk doing during this?
So Stealth Monk was there. I mean, I like him. I like him a lot. I think he's like misunderstood, but he was there and he thought I was just a nobody. I'm not saying I am a somebody, but he was like being very kind of dismissive of me. Like basically Blesnik opened, the fun player called the cutoff, and I had ace, deuce, seven, Badoogie. And I was thinking for like 5 seconds whether I should like free bet or not. And Blesnik snap calls the clock, you know? And I'm like,
this is fucking great. This really happened. This is a true story, right?
True story. I blocked about afterwards. I was so tilted. Are you here?
What the fuck?
Anyway, so I tanked for like 5 seconds. Blesnik calls the clock. The floor comes over. I'm like, what the fuck? I just end up calling with aces. I was like, I'll set mine, whatever. And then Stealth Monk starts tanking in the big blind, and then he looks at the floor. He's like, okay, I'm going to tank for 10 seconds to pretend I'm strong when really I just want to see a flop and don't get squeezed. Like, he's trying to like pretend this is what I was doing. But I just have like bad aces, you know? So I was just like, who the fuck is this guy? I didn't know who he was at the time. I was like, what's this guy's problem? I did nothing to him. He's being like an idiot. And then he was making comments like, oh my God, this is terrible, blah, blah, blah. Like, these guys, where did they get $10,000 from? I mean, I thought I played good. I mean, I was pretty happy with how I played in that tournament anyway. And then he found out who I was, and then he read my blog on 2+2, and then he was very sad about the whole thing. Like, he's quite an emotional guy, Stealth Monk, like, he has ups and downs and stuff. I really like him, don't get me wrong. I think he's a good player, stuff like this, and I hope in the future I'm going to be, like, very friendly and be good friends with him. But he started apologizing, saying he didn't know who I was and stuff like this, and I was just kind of saying to him, like, it doesn't matter if you don't know who I am. You should just, like, treat people, everyone, with respect and just let them play the game. I mean, it's $10,000. I mean, like, it's a big tournament. Let them be, you know, let them make a decision. Especially, I was only tanking for 10 seconds. They would keep calling the clock on me. I was only taking 10 seconds, you know what I mean? Like, I never tanked for more than a minute ever, and they just kept calling the fucking clock. I was just completely, and I went from having like 150,000 chips to having 20,000 chips. So like, I didn't want to make a decision in PLO that I wasn't sure about like too quickly and stuff like this. I just felt like, oh my God, this is crazy. So when I stacked Blesnik in this huge pot, I was just so happy that he was gone from the table and that I had these chips, you know, and it was fun. But yeah, Blesnik, fucking idiot, yeah. But I was very intimidated. I was actually, he has like although he comes across as like an idiot and like an asshole and stuff like this, he's actually quite intimidating the way he is because he's so aggressive in the way he is. Like, when he's talking to you, like, he's pointing at you, you know, like, and he's like, I uploaded a video on Twitter like 2 days ago. If you watch the video, he's on the video with Sean Deeb, like, arguing about something.
And he's like pointing at Deeb like this, and he's speaking like very aggressively. And I felt very, he's with these fucking New York gangsters. I don't know who the hell these guys were, but they were, didn't look like poker players, and they're playing 10K PLL, and they spoke like they're from the Bronx or something. Like, I didn't know who he was with or whatever, you know. I thought it was just weird. I don't know.
What a unique person. I don't think I've officially met him in person yet, so. But I know we have a very good mutual friend together. So I'm sure I'll meet him sooner than later. I've heard some very interesting stories about him outside of the obvious stories you hear about him.
Yeah, I know. I mean, I know that he's friends with the Irish guys. I mean, I think I'm not going to start like accusing him or anything, but I wouldn't be surprised if the whole Noel Hayes thing was set up between Brian Hastings and Blesnick. It makes complete sense. Like, Blesnick knows Noel Hayes for sure. Blesnick knows all of Noel Hayes' friends. And Hastings and Blesnick are obviously friends too. Hastings doesn't know other Irish guys. I mean, to me, it's quite obvious that Blesnick set it up. I don't know. I think he's behind all this stuff. I think he's pretty bad for the whole of all of this kind of stuff. So
Harrington knows the Irish people, the Ari Abu account from Ireland.
Interesting. That's obviously connected too, but also like this year, Blesnick pissed off an Irish guy. And Irish guys are not kind of guys you want to piss off. Like, Irish guys are fucking aggro, you know. Like, they're not scared. If someone calls them out, they'll take them to the car park, you know. And he insulted this Irish guy, and this Irish guy really wanted to like have a go at him, like, I don't know, fight him or whatever. Like, really like sort him out somehow. And it had to get diffused by all of the Irish connections that Blesnick had, you know. But one day, I mean, I wouldn't be surprised if something bad happens to him one day, you know. The thing is, he's obviously like super talented at poker. And he's obviously like one of the best PLO players in the world. So it's just a shame. I mean, I think Jungleman has like very. I have some Jungleman stories too, by the way. But I think Jungleman comes across similar to Blesnick, but very innocent. You know, like Blesnick comes across as a bastard who wants to like offend people. I think Jungleman's just very defensive in himself, and he's quite innocent and pure in his intentions, I think, compared to Blesnick. You know, I think they get put into the same category a lot.
But I don't think they get put in the same category at all. I'm not sure of anyone who puts them in the same category. Jungleman and Jared Blesnick, I mean, maybe they like have some mannerisms, but it's when it comes to exactly. Online approach, like there's nothing similar about those two.
I agree completely. A lot of people said that to me, that they think they're similar, but I think they're completely different too.
Some people compare Jungleman to Blesnick. I mean, the only sample size of Blesnick that we've seen is on television on Poker After Dark.
A lot of people have played with him live and stuff. He's been kicked out of rooms in Vegas. And I mean, a lot of people, he's quite famous for playing a lot of live poker in Vegas, I think. And people have had lots of bad experiences with him in the main event and live tournaments, whatever else.
You know? When I think about it more, I guess from that perspective, in terms of mannerisms at the table.
And even Poker After Dark, like the way he was, it's not similar to Jungleman, but like it's about being like not self-aware. Do you know what I mean?
When I think about it more, and I think about when you mentioned live poker specifically, and obviously we've seen Jungleman on television before playing, and he's, you know, he does some interesting things, so I can understand the comparison in that from that perspective. Yeah.
Yeah. Exactly. Yeah. The Jungleman, I really like Jungleman. He when I was working at Poker Strategy, he used to make videos for us. So the first time he made any videos, Jira. You remember Jira?
I remember the Jira scandal, correct?
So Jira, basically, we hired Jira to make videos for us. He came over, made a video for us. It was a really good video that Dogger's Head made, not him, I think. And then the next day, the whole scandal came out, I think. No, a week later, the scandal came out. Jungleman and Dogger's Head flew to Gibraltar, where we were working. And Jungleman, very nice, very innocent, like just comes across as a very nice guy, kind of not really knowing what's going on. He went back home to England, and he needed to make some training videos for us. So we send him like, we had really good guides. Like, Poker Strategy is a German company. It's like the processes are really good, like showing you exactly how to do things. And he just said to his guys, I can't do it. I've tried like 20 times. I just can't make a video. I don't know how to use Camtasia, whatever. So we explained again, and we were waiting weeks and weeks, because Jungleman was like a really big deal that we'd hired him. We really wanted to release his videos, you know. And it was getting frustrating, because every week he would come up with another excuse, like he just couldn't do it. So we said, okay, we'll fly someone over. So we flew someone over from Spain to England, and Jungleman was living with Full Flush at this time. So they had a house, and one of our employees went over to the house, and they said they had like a butler who was like going to McDonald's and getting Happy Meals every day and stuff like this. And And then eventually he made the video with my friend who was there, like pressing the buttons on his computer, like how to use Camtasia. And then we got the video back from him. A month later, Jungleman makes another video. So he sends a video in, and there's something on the video where if we release this video, like the stuff which would be on NVG and 2+2 and everything, it would be like out of control. I can't say exactly what it was, but it was just like it just wasn't self-aware. Like it's just weird to me that he's like so clever and can be like this in life.
Give us a hint. What did he say in this, allegedly in this video?
No. I seriously can't. It wasn't what he said. I can't say it. I mean, it was just like something like where if I sent something to you and I released it, you would. It was just like this crazy thing which I can't say.
You said some things to me I could release that might like be an MVG threat.
Yeah.
You say good things. You say the most entertaining things I've ever seen in my life. Emil says, wait, Full Flush had roomies. Full Flush was on the podcast, very against roommates. So you're saying he had a roommate, Jungleman.
He was living with Jungleman, I think. Maybe just for like a couple of weeks, but he was living with Jungleman. Or maybe they were hanging around and spending a lot of time together. I love Full Flush. I think he's like
amazing. You love everyone. You're Mr. Lover over here, Mr. PC. You know, I love them. No, I like them. No good. The Java stable. I like the Java stable a lot. Like you like everybody.
I'm actually like closet hater. I'm a closet hater. Like I actually hate on a lot of people, I'd say. Especially in the tournament world. Like just
who? Like who?
I don't know.
Name one person. Wait, one person. Come on. Is there like a public beef? Is there a public back and forth you guys have or something like that?
Sure, there has been. I'm trying to think. I don't like the Danish guys.
I don't know. I'm not familiar with the Danish guys.
Like Danish live guys. I don't know. I don't know. They seem to have some beef. I don't know. Some of them, I'm friends with some of them. Some of them seem to be aggro towards me. I'm not sure.
What do they try to like fight you or something? What do you mean aggro towards you?
I don't know. Just like I think it's weird when people like don't want you to know, like are very against you like finding out who they are and stuff. You know, like they protect their online identity so much. I don't know. Who do I hate? Say it quietly, just in case. I had this like problem when I was playing tournaments and I wasn't doing well. I had this like mental game problem, and it sounds like very bad for me. Like this is something which I probably shouldn't try to admit. But if a friend was deep in a tournament, I was like at times.
Be careful.
Yeah, if a friend was deep in a tournament and I was doing badly at the time, like if I was losing a lot of money, I would like almost not want them to win. Like I'd be like hoping they lost when they were in flips and stuff like this. It was like a very I had this like poor mental game where I was like very jealous of success that the people had who were like close to me. Mm-hmm. And I was like hoping that they didn't do as well so I could do better and stuff like this. I was very kind of competitive in a really bad way there. And like I had to speak to like mental coach and stuff to try to understand why I felt like this, because I don't think I'm necessarily a bad person or something, but something inside me, it's obviously not nice when you're trying to hope your friends lose, you know, like that's a very bad thing to kind of be, I think. So that was definitely something which I...
So what was the reason why?
It was just because I was just too focused on like people thinking I was good, you know, like having this blog, all this kind of stuff, like setting up these huge expectations for myself. Like I really had these huge monetary expectations and awards and stuff like this. I really wanted to win, and I was very bitter towards people because of this, you know. Yeah, I felt bitter towards
people. I think a lot of people feel that way about when they see. I think a lot of people, even not in poker, I think specifically outside of poker as well, I think there's a lot of people who feel that same way. Even family that feel that same type of way when you're having a pretty large amount of success. There are people who don't want to see you have more success, or they dislike you or hate you because they're not at a successful point in their own life.
Yeah. Do you feel like that or not? What did you?
For 100%. Oh yeah, definitely.
Why do you think?
The people never tell you it in person. They never tell you to your face, but you hear it from friends, or you hear it from other family members, and you can tell by the way people interact with you, or the things people say to you, especially people that are struggling in their own situation.
Yeah.
The body language, what they're saying, and then when people tell you things like this is something I never really thought of. It never was something I was aware of until I was, until I came back to the United States from Australia and I had a lot of that from you know, a couple people, certain people that were in my life at the time, they're in my life now. But that was when I really became aware, like, oh, wow, like I didn't like. And you know what's interesting is that's actually the time I stopped posting about any results. Like anytime I did well at poker, I just sort of stopped because I was always about posting downswings, upswings, my epic sessions I put in. Like I was all about like just talking about this stuff on all social media, blogging constantly about it. But when I came back to the States, I saw the impact it had on some relationships and the way that some people felt towards me that weren't having success in their own life. And I guess on one perspective, you can look at it like, oh, why do you care what those people think? But at the same time, you know, I was like, well, fuck man, I didn't even know this could have this type of, especially on family, like on your family. I didn't know it could have this type of reaction on your family where your family got this, you know, felt this type of way about you. So I pretty much since that time, I don't even really post about results anymore. I don't post anything like that. I don't post any graphs just because, you know, that's probably the biggest reason why. So is that sort of when you mentioned yourself, like when do you think you got past that? Was it when you started having more success or was it before that point?
Yeah. I think it was when I was starting to have more success, I guess. Maybe like if I didn't have success, maybe I'd still be like bitter and stuff. No, I mean, I definitely think it's possible. I was often looking out for like bad things that people do. Like if someone goes deep in a tournament and I watch them and they're a friend and they do something, I'm always like, if it could be good and it could be bad, I was always looking for it to be bad. Does that make sense? Like if someone makes a raise on the river and it could be good or it could be bad, I would like always be like very critical, like, oh my God, that river is so bad. How can you think like that, blah, 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 you know? I wasn't very open-minded towards things. I was always trying to like think that I was superior to people and I was better than people. I think I was not very self-aware at all. But I think I've definitely learned about that in the last kind of like 8 months or so. And I know when friends have good results now, I always try to congratulate them. Cause I know when I have a good result and someone writes to me and congratulates me and says, well played and stuff, I think it means like quite a lot, you know? So I always try to do the same now if friends have a deeper, and even if it's nothing huge, like, I just message them and say that kind of stuff, I guess. Yeah.
Makes sense. It's just an interesting thing to think about because that's something that I dealt with in a very big way and it made me reevaluate sort of how I approach situations. So. Mad One Lee says bragging is childish. That's the bottom line. Maybe
yeah,
to some extent. I mean, it's, I think when you work hard to have success at what it is you're doing, you want to talk about it, and to the point where it's like,
depends how you describe bragging. Like, I mean, what is bragging? Like, if I write like I played good today or I played bad today, you know, I'm not sure. Like, I don't really know how to define bragging. Like, if I say, okay, I won 20K today, is that me bragging or is that just me saying how the day went? Like. Mm-hmm. I use my blog as a diary, you know, like every time I do something in a day, I write it. You know, like even if I say like I did nothing today, I went for dinner and didn't do anything, I was lazy, I will write that, you know. If I have a bad day and do badly, I'll write I have a bad day. But if I win 20K, then I'm supposed to just not write that on the days where I do well or something. Right. A lot of people think that I'm like bragging a lot and like saying about how good and stuff I am and stuff, but I really don't think that's the case. Like maybe I'm just delusional about this, sorry. But like I said, I try to write when I'm sad and when I feel bad about things and when I think my mental game is very weak and stuff like this. But I mean, I can definitely understand why people would think I was like a big bragger and stuff like that. That's definitely understandable.
So that's the same way I used to. I used to like talking about my downswings more than my upswing because they were fucking epic. Yeah. But when you're blogging, like you're talking about the times you lose too. So obviously. You know, maybe I it's interesting. So people just, I guess they're becoming a bit more aware of when you talk about the times that you.
Well, don't get me wrong. I'm the opposite. I hate writing that I lost. I want to win, you know? So like when I was playing cash games, I used to post my graphs every day and I would play sessions until I was winning just because I didn't want to post a losing graph, you know? So like I'd play some marathon, like 18 hour sessions when I was losing because I can't post a graph on the blog when I'm losing. You know, I need to grind back and back and back. And if anything, it was more of a motivational tool. Like I think my blogs and stuff like this have helped me be motivated and try to do this and this and this. Like I almost get goals. That's one of my goals, you know, to be like, to post really good results in the blog. It's almost a goal rather than like, I'm not sure. Not sure exactly. Maybe
that makes sense.
Maybe it's delusional bragging. I'm not sure, but I don't intend it to come across like that. Like, I'm not.
I think if you can find any way to have goals for yourself, whether it's something like that, which is going to sound ridiculous to some people, I mean, it's better than having no fucking goals. Or I think there's a lot of people out there who would use something like that as a goal, but they might think it's a bad way to approach the situation. But if you can use that to something to fuel you to have success at what it is you're doing, I think that's I mean, I think that's a fine thing to have.
There is a lot of guys, especially on 2+2, who only blog when they win. You know, like they say, okay, time for an update, dot dot dot, and then they post it and just had a big win. You know, like that. I think a lot of guys are like that. They only want to post when they win. I think that is something. But I try to not be like that. But I definitely understand why it can be perceived to be like that, for sure.
And I used to, you know, it's weird. I used to really like love blogging about when I would lose 50 buy-ins in a session. Like I would just like really enjoy that part. Like obviously in the town, like I want to go hit by a bus, but like I enjoyed writing about that. And then, you know, and then once I started winning, I stopped blogging as much. But when I started losing again, I started blogging again. So it was kind of like, it's.
Yeah. I mean, I was actually going to quit the blog because I was
winning too much.
I was feeling kind of bad about how I was maybe coming across. And I think like Vanessa Selbst posted some stuff and Anthony Gregg said something really nice to me in Monaco and stuff like this. And that made me kind of keep it open because I found out there was a lot of people just watching passively, like reading passively, who enjoyed reading about it, but just didn't want to post so much, you know? And often when you post something, the people who reply are often going to be the haters, you know, especially when you can be anonymous behind the screen name. And I've kind of understood and accepted that, I think.
So they were actively following along with your blog, following along with what was happening with you, and they told you in person that they enjoyed reading it, and that sort of motivated you to want to keep doing it.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, cool. Exactly.
Why do you think that is? Why do you think their validation for following along with your blog made you want to keep doing it? Because you enjoyed that validation that you got from them, and you sort of wanted to, like, what exactly was it when they said that to you? Like, why?
I guess I realized there's like a purpose behind it. Like it was, like I said, I enjoy writing. I used to be a journalist. I like to write poems. I'm halfway through writing a book, which I'm not going to go into details. My housemate didn't know about that. And I'm doing. I like to write. You know, I have a website called wugwug.com, which I don't really write anymore on, but I have a lot of content on there and articles and stuff like that. I don't know. I just enjoy it, and when you get appreciation from it, I mean, I don't know, it feels nice, I think. Mm-hmm. Just honest, I guess.
So you weren't getting anything nice said to you previous to that? And that was like the first time you got something nice said to you?
I'm the kind of guy who is very, like I said, I used to be this like internet warrior when I was like 18 to 20. I was very defensive. Like if someone ever wrote anything bad about me, I was like going crazy. Like, yeah, you're wrong because of X, Y, and Z, you know? And, even last year, I think I used to do it a lot. I was very defensive. I think actually I have a very defensive nature in general. Like if I'm having like a dispute with some friends and they disagree with me and it's like a kind of a sour, it's like kind of an awkward silence and stuff like that, I'll be very defensive and I won't try to diffuse the situation kind of thing. I'll just be, I think it's just kind of a bad thing about my personality, I guess, which I guess I, at least I'm aware of it now. And on my blog, when someone used to question something or come in and be aggro, I would often just think, well, this isn't worth the hassle, you know, like, fuck these guys, I'm over this, you know, I'm giving out content for free and strategy, why haven't people been more appreciative, you know? And then now I realize that it's just, that's like a really bad way to think of it, you know, and I can also learn from other, I like to ask questions now and like get people's, I think a really good question is this kind of like speaking to your friends from real life kind of thing. Like, I think that's something which I can learn from other people too. It's like, I often post things in the blog, which I'm unsure about, and then try to get people to start speaking about it, you know, and it becomes like a discussion and stuff like this. So yeah, I think that's...
So when you say the blog, you mean the thread on 2+2, correct?
Yeah, like diary, whatever you want to call it, yeah.
Okay, cool. Just want to make sure so people, if they want to find it, they can Google. What can they Google? Pads 1161... Bracelet hunting?
Bracelet hunting, yeah. Bracelet
hunting. I sometimes like to go in there, but the fucking threads are so long and there's so much, I'm just like, ah, fuck this shit. And like the post each like original poster makes is so, every post is so long. I'm like, fuck, 60 pages, not gonna be able to do it. Like I just give up and I check out.
Yeah. So, I mean, most people in poker, because we have so few life skills, like we haven't worked in jobs. We like haven't interacted with anyone like properly. Well, obviously we have, but like compared to most people, we haven't interacted with the real world hardly at all. Like we're obviously going to have these huge mental and personal kind of stuff that we're just not good at. If that's kind of being too defensive, if that's like being too difficult to deal with people, if that means you're like looking for the bad things in people, stuff like that, like we just haven't learned a lot of that stuff. And that's where like life skills, I think, kind of that's the kind of stuff you lose from playing poker. You know, there's a lot of things you gain from poker, but just being in an office 9 to 5 and dealing with people that you don't like and having to understand how to get along with them and stuff like that. Like when you're a poker player, if you don't like someone, you just go back to your house and start playing poker. And if someone starts writing shit to you on a forum, you can tell them to go fuck himself, and then that's the end of it. But if you're working a job and you don't like someone, you have to pretend to like them, you have to get along with them, you know? And that's like stuff that we don't really learn when we're poker players. It's very easy for us to just tell someone to go fuck himself and then just not speak to him, delete him, block him from messaging you, whatever else. You know, that's the easy way out. And with poker, it's so easy to have the easy way out like that, you know?
Maybe it was a good thing. Like, I mean, I remember I worked as a server and a bartender when I was younger. That was the best job ever. If you listen, if you're 19, 20, 21, 22, get a bar, be a bartender, be a server. Your GG per 100 is very high. But maybe that, I guess that maybe that experience. So instead, if I was to start playing poker when I was 18 online, I would never have dealt with these people. I would have never had to, you know, navigate that situation. And maybe that's sort of, maybe that's a reason why I'm not as awkward as some other that have played a lot of poker hours on the internet. And I mean, I played probably more hours than a lot of the, what you'd consider to be the nerdy poker players or those type of people. Like that should be me in theory, but maybe because I had these jobs out there in the world and lived in the city and working in the city where a lot of different types of people aren't interacting with people, maybe that sort of helped me avoid that thing. Cause I've always wondered why didn't I get the, maybe some people might say I am fucking weird. I don't know. But why didn't I get the traditional online poker players' tendencies that a lot of poker player friends I know have?
Yeah. I mean, I worked in a bar as well, like Glass Collecting and stuff too. It's interesting.
When did you work in a bar? How old were you?
Well, I was 16. I worked in a supermarket on tills. And then I worked in a bar as a glass collector. Then I worked in a bar as a barman. And then I started working like in events, you know, like running events in clubs and stuff like this when I was at university. Cool. With sport, because I'm into football. Do you say football in Canada or
call it football, soccer? Call it both.
What do you call it in Canada?
I live in America. I live in Chicago, but I call it soccer.
The Canadians call it soccer too.
Yes.
All right. Okay. I mean, no, no. When you're in a sports team, you kind of you're speaking with when you. I think that's probably the best way for like poker players to kind of get away from other poker players and be in like social environments and stuff like this. Be with people who are earning way less money. Be with people who are from different countries. Be with people with different life skills, different ages, all sorts of stuff like that. You know.
Wait, so playing or being a fan?
Playing, like being in a sports club, like because. When you play sports, your mind just goes away from poker for those 2 hours a week. You know, like that's the chance you can just like forget about all downswings, forget about how bad you've run, forget about how tilted you are, whatever. Forget about a horse that's in 100K makeup. That's the time where you just like focus on the sport and like you really get into it. You know, and like you go for some drinks afterwards or whatever else. And I think that's like a good way of kind of improving some life, maybe not life skills, but just like improving balance to your life. I guess, you know, like. Having to balance.
Do you think people out there that are in and potentially feel like they need some more life experience, you think they should potentially join a type of sports team or something like that?
Yeah. I think it's really good. Not even a sports team, even if you just like play for fun once a week or twice a week, you know, like five-a-side soccer, whatever you want to call it. It's like a good way to just like get out of everything, I think. I manage a football team now in Budapest. So I used to, this is kind of why I've always wanted to be good in poker, is because I failed in soccer. Like when I was like young, like very young, I was very good at soccer, like 10 to 15 kind of age. And then I had trials and stuff. I was in like at Southampton Football Club. You know, you probably don't know this, but they're like a Premier League team. And in my team, there was a guy called Gareth Bale. You know Gareth Bale? You look like Gareth Bale a little bit.
I guess he's on Real Madrid, correct?
He's the most expensive footballer in the world. He got signed by Real Madrid for like 100 million. I was watching a documentary on him yesterday with my housemate, or 2 days ago. And they said in the documentary that Southampton told him, look, you're not going to be a football player. You're not good enough kind of thing. You have one last game to impress us. And then he kind of got given like the green light to keep going when I got the red light to like stop playing, you know? And the whole documentary is all about like how hard he's worked to be a football player. Like he wasn't born like strong or fast. and he made himself into being the best football player in the world. And I think I wrote a blog about it once, but it was like, I want to be like the Gareth Bale of poker. So like, I want to be the guy that's, I'm not super smart. Like, I'm intelligent, but I'm not like anywhere close to being the smartest poker player. And the thing is, in poker, the best guys are not always like the cleverest guys. They're the guys who've worked the hardest, you know, like they're the guys who've made themselves very good. And in football, I had a chance to be very good, but I didn't like fulfill my potential. So in poker, it was kind of like, I don't want to kind of go back and be like another failed footballer in the poker sense, you know, because I've already
hit. You mentioned earlier, you're not actually working hard though.
Yeah, but I think over like the last 4 years, I worked very, very hard. Like I put in the grind, you know, of like the time where you really have to put in the work. I put in the work then, you know, and now I'm still working, but I'm kind of chilling a little bit more, you know, like when Gareth Bale, now that he's worked so hard to get to where he is, he's still working hard, but you know, he's already worth the mm-hmm. 50 million or whatever he's worth, you know.
Sorry, are you friends with this Gareth Bale?
No, not at all. But, I mean, we played in the same team, you know, like same, we lived in, when we were there, when I was down there, you all live in the same house, you know, for like the 2 weeks or whatever it is, you know. Mm-hmm. So I knew him at the time, but now, I mean, he probably would remember, but he probably wouldn't recognize me, put it that way. So yeah, I mean, I devoted like 8 years, 10 years of my life to football, to soccer, but I only devoted like 80%, you know, like I didn't do the 100%. And to be the best in soccer, you really need to give 100%, because every single kid in England wants to be a soccer player, you know, like that's what every single person wants to be when you're a kid. And I was like drinking on the streets or like hanging around with the wrong people, getting into trouble when I was like 15. And Gareth Bale was like in the gym getting big, you know, like working out, like practicing football, getting sleep before big matches, stuff like this, you know. I'm not saying he was 100% perfect, but he was kind of like the model pro footballer. And that's kind of, that kind of gave me like some motivation towards poker. But football in general, I just think it's a team sport. Like it's nice to not just be out for yourself, you know, like kind of like, it's good to like do something for somebody else on your team. Like you make a tackle that saves somebody else or something like this, you know?
Good old soccer, man. Good old football soccer.
Can you play?
I play basketball. You want to play some ball?
No.
We play basketball over here, Poppy. We play ball.
In Budapest, they have poker players. They play basketball every day, I think. The guys.
So we got basketball. We got Eastern European girls. We got PLO. We got low cost of living. I feel like every podcast I have on, I'm get convinced to go visit somewhere else or live somewhere else. Like last time with Brian Rast, it was Brazil. And I think also Colombia was in there too. Who else? I think Jeff Gross was also Brazil too, though. Or that may have been, yeah, it was Brazil or Argentine. A lot of Brazil love lately.
I would like to. I mean, my parents, they're probably not watching anymore, but my parents, whenever I've suggested I'm going to go to South America, they've always been like really scared about my safety. My dad's like close down the heart to talk about it. I think they're very kind of, my dad in particular is very kind of, dismissive about the idea of me like traveling to these kind of crazy countries, I guess. Mm.
Do you know you know Dan Fu, David?
Yeah. He's a nice guy. He's a nice guy. Very nice.
He's a very sweet guy. He's a fucking. I like Dan Fu, man. I like him a lot. So he might be a scripter, but he's my friend that's a scripter. So it's
very
okay.
Nice.
Friend that's a motherfucking scripter, but that's okay.
He is the kind of guy who would treat you the same if you play like NL2 or NL like.
Nah. He's secretly he's said some things in the online to other. No.
I know he has a lot of friends who he hangs around with are playing like a lot lower stakes than him, and he's like, and he's very well liked by everyone here in Hungary. I think not many people hate on him at all, and he's
some aggressive things to certain people.
Really?
Mm-hmm.
He's very good at basketball, you know.
That's not true.
No, he's very good. I think I would bet him against you 1-on-1.
He's 6'10", 9 or something. He could post. He just posts me up. He's 6'9", like 400 pounds.
Yeah. I mean, he's good. That makes him good.
He's 6'9", 400 fucking pounds.
Yeah,
I'm 6'2", 185. There, it's a basketball is a huge height's a huge advantage in basketball.
Yeah.
With that said, how much you want to bet?
Double or nothing.
How much you want to bet? Let's discuss this right now. How much you want to wager?
Double or nothing on the. Well, no, I mean, yeah, we can.
1,000. 1,000 best of three. No, best of five. Best of five games. Me versus Dan Fu 1-on-1.
All right, then.
$1,000 is that booked?
Yeah, booked.
That's booked.
Yeah.
Okay.
$1K?
$1K. $1,000.
Yeah, USD.
You never play basketball, right?
This is Dan Fu.
Dan Fu. David, he's 6 foot nine.
Yeah, I'm in.
Okay, so, you realize you're drawing dead in this, right? It's a best of five. So Dan Fu's going to get tired by the time. One-on-one's intense. He's going to get tired when we start the game.
It's fine. Relax. We got this.
Dan Fu, let's play, kid.
He'll train for it. You have to come to Budapest, you know. If it costs me $1,000 to bring you to Budapest, that's fine. You know, I can live with that.
That makes sense. Okay. I mean, it could be in Vegas, too.
No.
Why can't we play in Vegas?
I want home turf here. I mean, Dan Fu in the heat in Vegas, I don't like it.
We
you know?
Play indoors in Vegas.
All right. Okay. I'll speak to him. The bet's booked in Budapest. Vegas, we can discuss.
There's no fucking way Dan Fu's beating me. And I don't care if he's 6 foot. I don't care. There's no chance he's beating me in basketball.
I don't know. Maybe.
I mean, yeah. I hope. I don't know. He might beat me. He could. He's 6 foot nine. Like, he's got it. That's all you got. That's what you need, man.
Yeah, it's good.
Five matches are too much. Exactly. That's exactly why I said five matches, Poppy. It's huge motivation to be fit again. Dan Fu, if this gets you fit, I will happily donate $1K to the cause. I don't mind at all, man.
Let's go, Dan Fu. Let's go.
I don't mind at all. Was it something interesting? Hagar said in the chat. He said, we were talking about the friends thing. He said, this is interesting because I have friends who kind of get their fix off negativity, and I have been negative for the last 6 months, but now things are getting better. They seem taken aback, somewhat evasive and subdued when I share positivity.
So he used to be jealous of his friends?
He has friends who kind of get their fix off negativity, and him personally has been negative for the last 6 months, but now things are getting better for him. Yeah. And his friends seem taken aback, somewhat evasive and subdued when he shares positivity.
Oh, okay. That's interesting. Yeah, that is interesting. I think, I mean, it's like kind of why girls are never friends, are properly friends. Like, people say a lot of time, like, it's very hard for two females to have a friendship because they're always very jealous and bitchy about it, right? Or is that, I don't want to have Kate Hall on my back or anything like this, but I think
I am not saying anything that's going to get Kate Hall. I like Kate Hall.
I'm sorry, Kate. I don't know. I mean, I've heard this from girls. The girls have told me, like, it's very difficult to have friendships because I'm sure obviously there's girls who are very good friends. I'm just saying, I think it's difficult for girls compared to guys to have a friend. I don't know. Maybe I should backtrack on that. I don't know.
Nah, they ain't gonna. How long are we into this right now? They're not watching anymore, Puppy. There's no chance they're watching right now that are gonna get angry at that. Say some things that might get them. They're not watching right now. 2:21 into it, they're not gonna be watching. So
that's good. That's good.
You ain't got to worry about them watching this long. So, let me check my list. Drunk Life. Oh, Drunk Life mentioned something on Twitter. You know Drunk Life, right?
He's the Wild Hungarian's boyfriend.
Correct. He said, ask him about MDMA and his sex life. Kid loves chess.
MDMA? No, he's joking.
Drunk Life says, ask him about MDMA and his sex life, please. Kid loves chess.
MDMA is, I've never taken any drugs before. Never taken any drug before. The one thing you were saying, talking about girls and stuff, I didn't really want to talk about. The one tip I would give for guys who want to my friend's laughing here. The one tip I'd give for friends, for guys who want to like meet girls and stuff is like, guys who are going up to girls in clubs at like 11 p.m. or like 1 a.m. or something like this, it's very hard. These girls have already been propositioned by like 50 guys already. So when you come over, you're just like another guy in that list, right? Unless you're like devilishly handsome like yourself, Joey, it's very difficult to just impress them on physical terms, right? But if so, I think like guys maybe get with him.
100 girls in a night, for fuck's sakes, Poppy.
Benjamin.
No. Can't say that.
You're saying Benjamin tries 100 girls in a night, allegedly.
What do you think is your average?
Well,
if you go to a club, like how many girls do you think you try to speak to? Honestly.
10?
10, no.
You think more?
Yeah. Ben has some good style. What are your tips? Ben likes to dance.
I like to dance too, Ben. Ben, let's see a move. Ben, get in the background. Let me see you hit a move real quick.
He's still on the grind. Okay. You're still playing? 18
left.
The podcast run good.
Wait, no, Ben's still in the tournament. 18 people are left. It's a day 2 on what site? iPoker?
Yeah. This will be biggest out of score if we win.
Holy fuck, the podcast run gets so real. It's just too sick how good the podcast run good is, honestly.
I swear he was petrified to go in before the podcast started, you know?
I mean, it's true. There are people, like, the podcast run good is extremely real.
It's sick.
It really is.
That is really sick. I'm probably gonna go quite soon and rail him to victory. But I think going to a girl in a coffee shop who's by herself, who is not with friends, who's in the coffee shop because she's got nothing else to do all day, she's just passing time, she's not in a rush because she's sitting down having coffee, reading the paper. She has time to chat and talk, you know. She's not with her friends, so she doesn't have to like pretend that she doesn't want to talk to a guy. Like, if there's a group of five girls and you go up to them, they all want to pretend like they're defensive, like, oh, fuck guys, you know, like this kind of stuff. But if there's a girl by herself who's going to be more open-minded, you say like a nice line to her straight away. I think this is more GTO than going up to girl after girl after girl in clubs. I think like that's very, very bad.
Hold that point. I've been drinking a lot of water. I'm playing ball. I got to go to the bathroom real quick. It's been a while. I'm going to give you a question, and then I'm going to come back to that point you just said right there. The question is going to be... pizza? Nope, not pizza. Ask him who he would hire as a coach for November 9. Go.
If I hired a coach for November 9, I would hire eight players who would all be able to do a simulation. So, like, not necessarily the eight best poker players, but the eight players who would be prepared to, like, dedicate time. Like, I wouldn't want to hire Timex if he only wanted to, like, do it for making the money and like he'd work like the hours I paid him. I'd want guys who are like my friends who were really into it and really wanted to help me and go like over the expectations that I would ask them to do. The first person I would ask would be the Drunk Life, I think. He's a good friend and he understands sit and goes and ICM very well. And he's the kind of guy who would put a lot of time into it. Secondly would be Ben, my housemate. He'd be very into it. He would spend a lot of time, and he has some very good ideas. And thirdly would be European. He's like my papi, very, very good.
Papi.
Okay. Fourth would be Fido, but I'd probably have to pay a little bit. Fifth would be Martin Jakobsen, but it's unrealistic, so I wouldn't ask him. I don't know. Those kind of guys. Like my friends, I wouldn't hire guys who were in it for the money. I would hire guys that I would do it for myself for them. Does that make sense? Like, if one of my friends made a final table and I would help them excessively, then I would hire those kind of same guys in return, like the Drunk Life, like Ben, like European, these kind of guys. Guys that are going to sit down every day and speak about it with me. Not guys like, I'm not calling Timex out here because obviously he's doing it as a job, but not guys like who would just do it for like an hourly kind of thing. I find the whole like coaching November 9 thing like super interesting. They're like, how the guys find people. Like, I heard Hastings like approached Blumenfield asking if he could coach him, and then Blumenfield
allegedly,
and then Blumenfield shouted him allegedly too. I heard. I don't know.
Wait. They said that on November 9 telecast. How fucked up is that?
They did.
They said that on the telecast. They said that Blumenfield and Hastings got into a big pot, and Blumenfield won, and Hastings approached Blumenfield for coaching after November 9, and he said no.
Wow. That's interesting. I mean, he definitely got coached. He was playing like absurd. He 4-bet A7 blind versus blind, stuff like this. I mean,
that's what the legend does, man. That's what the legend does.
He's very smart.
They said he got coaching from his friends. His friends. Yeah,
it's bullshit, I think. I think it's bullshit. I would love to be part. I'm not saying I'm good enough to do it, but I would love to be part of a team who did the coaching for the November 9. I think it's like a really fascinating thing. I wouldn't even want to get paid much money. I would just do it for the fun and the experience. I'd love to do it. I have an idea that I would like to do as well. I probably shouldn't say it, but I would love to coach someone with a limping strategy. So going into the final table and limping every single hand that you want to play, because all these guys like Stern is coached by Jakobsen, like how to free bet, and Beckley's coached by Diprong and how to free bet and how to play aggressively preflop. And if you limp, then they're not gonna go crazy against you because they're expecting you to limp call. And these guys are shit scared to play post flop. So if you limp, they're expecting you to limp call. So they're never gonna put pressure on you, or not as much pressure. You're gonna play more pots. You can limp raise, and then they can't ask their coach what to do because they haven't gone through all these simulations. Because when they do through the simulations, it's like, okay, player X raises the cutoff with Y big blinds. Here's how we should adjust. They don't know. Okay, player X limps off this stack size. How should we play? So they don't have the coach's voice in their head. So I would go ahead and just limp every single hand and like put people into like crazy spots that they haven't been practicing for the last 6 months or 4 months.
Can you say the people that are limping every hand probably don't understand how to play a proper limping strategy as well?
Yeah, but I would build a limping strategy for the guy who I was helping with. Like, this is how we're going to limp. And also, you can expect how people are going to adjust against it. So if you have guys who are very aggressive, you can expect how they're going to adjust incorrectly to the limping strategy. So you can, like, limp raise against them. Or if you have guys who are going to be very honest and not isolate you very wide, then you can limp call against them. You can even limp fold against some guys like Neuville, who would never isolate you. But against Beckley, maybe you can limp raise, and he's not going to have his coach in his ear telling him what to do, you know? So against guys that you think are weak, maybe like Cannulli and Beckley, who are probably not the best players, if you start limp raising against them, everything that Brian Rast and Phil Locke has told them how to play, they can't put this into practice. All the money they've spent on coaching against you, then they can't fuck you anymore, you know? Like, you're going to be one step ahead of them. They're going to have no idea what to do. And then you go into the break, and then they develop some kind of strategy to play against you, and then you start raising, and then it's all, like, fucking up in their minds and stuff, you know? Like, I think it's just good to go in there and play differently to how everyone else plays, rather than just everyone playing this pre-flop, pre-betting strategy that everyone's worked out how to play pretty well, you know? That's how I'd go about it, I think.
Might have been too much strategy, Poppy.
Yeah. Said too much.
I see people importing that into their November 9 future coaching packages, which I'm sure some people will hear that.
Yeah, maybe, but maybe not as well.
You think Cannulli plays bad? I don't know, man. You know, why? He's a live pro. He's got a lot of heart.
I mean, I think he made some, like,
he was ready to die for this, man.
He made some significant mistakes, like against Negreanu. I think he folded like King 10 of clubs, I think, in small blind versus a button min raise. He folded nines for like a 12 or 13 big blind shove, I think, which was definitely a call. Some of his sizings I thought were off. I mean, I don't want to stop the rating people or anything. He's done, you have to remember, I busted the main event after 3 hours, and he's played like 200 hours more than I have in this tournament. So, like, he's obviously doing things very, very, very well, and he's obviously a very, very good player. Don't get me wrong. I just feel like that he'd be a guy who would be potentially easier to exploit than someone like Jakobsen last year or Van Hoof. These guys I'd be fucking shitting myself against. But against guys like Cannulli and Beckley, I'd feel okay. But again, like, these guys, good luck for them. I don't want to berate them or anything like this.
I like Cannulli. I like that kid.
Yeah, everyone seems to like him a lot. I don't know. He tilts me. I don't know. I think he's annoying. I don't know.
A lot of people tilt me. What do you think about the McKeon guys? He tilt you?
McKeon?
Yeah.
So yesterday, his rail started messaging me, asking for reads on the players, their physical reads. So I started texting back some physical reads. And then I did this for free, you know, like, it's fine. I'm just trying to help out, whatever. And I checked this morning, and he blocked me on Twitter. Like, he blocked me from reading his tweets, which was really weird. I'd never said anything bad towards him, I don't think. Maybe I said something and he didn't like it or something like this. I don't know. But he didn't. I don't know. He blocked me. So I wanted him to win or to come first or second. And now I don't know. I don't know what I think, Joey. I don't know.
I gotta be honest, dude. If that guy fucking like the whole staring thing, that just like if I'm like a person who's not a professional player, I'm like, dude, what the fuck are you doing? Like what?
That's why he does it, though. He puts people into like difficult stuff. Like, yeah. He's I'm not sure why.
No, man, I'm out on the strategy. It was uncomfortable.
I'm not sure why he's doing that. I don't know why he's doing that. I'm not sure.
This shit makes fucking people feel uncomfortable.
Yeah.
I'm sorry. I'm watching. I'm like, what the fuck are fucking people doing? Like, maybe that's how live people. I mean, Timex is like that too. Maybe Timex birthed this entire industry
If you're thinking about bluffing someone and they're staring at you, I think you're less likely to bluff them just because you're scared to get a read off you or something like this. Something I do is, like, when I play live against somebody, if I'm in a pot against them and I know I'm going to fold, I'll look at their neck for like a minute, just staring at their neck, and I start looking under the table at their legs, and then, like, I'll smile at them and say, okay, buddy, nice hand, and then I'll fold. And then next time when I'm in a pot against them and I raise and they're thinking about doing something, I just stare at their neck again or stare at their legs, and usually they're thinking that I have a read on them or something. So I think that's kind of like something that Timex does, like, he's just trying to make them uncomfortable and less likely to play pots against him and to fold more, I think. I would assume.
Mike Beckett on YouTube, shout out to Mike. I've never seen Mike in the chat. What's up, Mike? He says the staring thing is a lot of the reasons amateurs don't want to play. I don't think so.
I think amateurs kind of like it. I think, like,
they like being stared at by these fucking.
Yeah, I think it's like, I think it's almost like, it's, I think it's okay. I think it's okay.
I love this. I love it. Maybe I'm going to start doing this stuff. Like, if I do that in like a 10-20 appeal, like, get the fuck out of the game, bro. Like, you're not playing in the game. Like, the games I want to play in, you're not staring at the fucking dudes. They're gonna be like, get the fuck out of the game. You're not playing in the game anymore.
Yeah. I think on the final table, you should
try stare. I feel like I'm doing it right. Can you do the McKeon stare for me real quick?
It's just, I don't know. It's just very,
Slams the hands down after that.
He checks like, that's how he checks. Like, he slams his hand down. I don't know.
Someone said, any thoughts on McKeon's twitchiness last night? He looked like he was on drugs compared to his behavior on day 7. And then a couple people said Adderall, which.
Yeah. I mean, he blocked me, so I don't know what you're saying. I can't read his fucking tweets. He blocked me. I don't know.
A lot of people seem not to like him. They seem to think he's a.
I like him. I like him. He's good too. He's a closer. He closes tournaments out. I like him. I think he's good. I mean, I just bet on him against you. You know, $100. I hope he wins. I hope he wins now. We have a bet. Let's do 5 minutes more. Then I think I'm gonna rail my friend to the podcast victory here.
Sounds good. 5 minutes more. 5 minutes more. What can we get out of this last 5 minutes? What can we get out of this last 5 minutes? Let me look at this list real quick. Ask him that. So what happened there? Da-da-da. Ask him how does it feel? So be so fucking lucky to go from negative 10K to 250K in 700 tournaments. How's it feel, kid? Feel good? Good feeling?
Yeah, it was good. It felt good. Yeah.
How good it feels. Tell the guy how good it feels. It feels good.
This pisses my friends off. Yeah, this is the kind of thing that pisses my friends off. This score that I made, it was like the biggest ever Sunday million of all time. And I came into the final table like second out of 9. And the pay jumps were like 100K, 200K, 300K, 400K, 500K, all the way to first, which was a million. And then I got it in pre-flop with like ace-queen against queen-eight and lost against one of my friends. And I finished 9th for 100K when like my EV of winning was like 500K or something. So my friends hate it that I say that I'm unlucky. Like, I always say that I'm really unlucky because I lost this pot. And I genuinely believed it for a long time. Like, I was kind of deluded. But then I kind of realized that like I was very lucky to get there in the first place. And yeah, I used to be very defensive when people said I ran good. Like, people were like, yeah, this guy, fucking Sunrunner, he runs really good. And the truth is that I've ran very well, and I've run way above expectation. But for a long period of time, I just thought I was the best and that everyone was talking bullshit. And I was kind of deluded about it. But I realize now that I was definitely deluded, and I definitely ran very, very, very well, way above expectation. And I think I'm just a lucky tournament player. That, yeah.
Han says online MTT rankings.
I mean, they change so frequently, but I would say number one.
Have they changed too recently?
I have some rankings here written down. Let me find it.
Okay.
Can
Ben say entrepreneur and casino for me one more time, please?
Ben?
He really wants to be an entrepreneur. Hi, Joe. Entrepreneur.
How the fuck do they say it like that? It's just so sick. Okay, casino?
From here. From your throat.
Casino.
There you go. Casino.
Casino. Oh, shit, you're right. Oh, God. I mean, I'm getting there. It's my second time doing it from the throat. Okay, thank you. Now I know how to do the French person voice. Okay. Casino. No. Entrepreneur. I love French people. All right, online MTT rankings.
Number one, Fedor.
Fedor Holz.
Undisputed.
AKA
undisputed.
Crown Up Guy.
Yeah, undisputedly number one. Number two, Almerix. He's part of my coaching company, but he's up more money than anyone else is, and he's never had it. He's up like 1.3 million, and his biggest ever score is $50,000. So like, he's just consistently won for like the last 5 years. Number three, Sam Greenwood from Run It Once. He just has a very good thought process on poker. Number four, Fresh OD. This guy is crazy. You won't know this guy. He'd be a great, interesting guy. He plays like 5 tables of cash games, 10 tables of sit and goes, 20 tables of tournaments all at once, and he crushes everything. He's like unbelievable. Very underrated. Number five, Rui NF. He like won a lot of money during WCOOP. Number six is a guy called Sejakas. He chopped it with Ben86 in the 50K. He's very good.
Sejakas.
Number seven is European. Number 8 is Eisenhower. Number 9 is NJW.
Wait, who's the 8?
Eisenhower. He's like a Swedish guy. He's done very well recently.
Okay.
These are not necessarily the guys who I think are the best. These are the guys who right now deserve to be in the top 10.
Sure, okay.
Number 9 is MJW. He did very well in W Group. And number 10 is a guy called Romeo Pro. He's a shout out for Romeo Pro. He gives I think 50% of his money away to charity. He has a blog on 2+2, and he gives away thousands and thousands of money to charity. So he's a good guy to follow. And I don't know where I am. I think I'm in there somewhere, but I'm not gonna say exactly where.
Okay. Thank you for the rankings, Poppy. Thank you. CG, you're going to go soon. CG asked a question, but it might be a long answer. What does he think of the wave of high-stakes NL cash game players playing the high rollers? Their styles much different from MTT grinders. The Big Dick Donger Kim, WCG, I guess.
The thing which I have here is Christoph Olgerson. You know this guy?
2067197025 7, that guy?
So he's recognized to be one of the slowest players in the game, you know? So, when I know I'm going to do, let's say I have the nuts and you raise, and I'm thinking about going all in on the river, I'm always going to go all in on the river. So, I'm thinking in my head, oh my fucking God, I'm going to have so many chips. They're going to look so nice in this chip stack. I'm going to fucking block tonight how fucking many chips I have, blah, blah, blah. He takes, 3 minutes to decide to go all in when he's always going to go all in. He's, a genius. And I always wonder, what is this guy thinking when he's just got these 3 minutes to himself, which he's tanking? I would love to know what goes through his mind when he's got these 3 minutes just spare, what exactly is in his mind that he's thinking? Is he thinking the super GTO way of working out this hand whilst he's making the decision? Or it's always intrigued me. They're very clever people. When they tank for such a long time, when they've always decided what they're going to do, I always wonder what they're thinking and how much different they're thinking to me in those kind of spots. But generally, people like Anski and Brian Roberts, you know this guy, Just the Nuts?
A-A-A-A-B-B-B-C-C-C on PokerStars?
Is that him? No, just the Nuts.
Allegedly. Mm-hmm.
I'm kind of surprised that he's playing these no limit tournaments when he doesn't really play cash games no limit. And I remember he went very deep in the main event and he was texting Anski for shoving shots and stuff like this. It just seems weird to me that now he's playing these super high rollers. And you get a lot of these PLO guys, a lot of Finnish guys are playing 10K turbos and stuff like this, Barry Sweet and these kind of guys.
Barry Sweet's not. You're talking about Vroom.
Vroom. Okay. Sorry. Yeah. It just seems weird, these guys are just playing 10K no-limit events when they probably have no idea about reshoving ranges and lots of ICM spots. So it kind of feels like they're just punting and gambling a little bit. I don't really understand why they're doing it. But obviously the top guys like Christoph and these guys and they're crushing. They're doing very well.
It's you're saying Izzeldrun, Leo Nordin, and Ad Otson aren't plus EV in these no-limit hold'em tournaments?
I would in the turbo events. I don't think. I mean.
I don't think so either. Those kids love gambling, though, man. Yeah, I don't think it's.
I'm not trying.
Izzeldrun goes deep, man. Izzeldrun might be a boss. You never know. It could be a no limit hold'em.
I'm not trying to I just find it weird that they decide to do it. That's all. Why they decide to do this, I don't know.
Too much money sometimes, and a lot of gamble.
I was playing PLO with tell me some guys, PLO guys.
You're playing live PLO with them.
I think I sent you a picture. No. Very tall.
I think that was that Vroom?
No.
No, that was Lottie.
Lottie, yeah. I've been live KO with Lottie. Yeah, this guy. He seems like a nice guy. I like him.
Lottie, friend of the podcast. Very good friend of the podcast. Guest of the podcast.
All these guys actually have a story. I'm very good friends with Felix Stevenson. You know this guy?
Of course I'm friends with Felix, man.
We
had a lot of fun together over the series this year. Shout out to Felix, man. We have fun.
And I sent a picture to him of Odds Oddson on my PLO table. And then Felix sent me back a pic. Felix wrote in the group, sent the picture to Odds Oddson, and he sent back a really funny message to Felix, who the fuck is sneaking me or something like this. And for the next minute, Odds Oddson was just staring everyone down on the table for 20 seconds. Could this guy be taking the picture? Could this guy? He was looking back at the picture to see the angle and stuff like this. And I was trying to give away that I wasn't watching what he was doing. And he's really pissed about it for some reason. It's quite funny. I don't know. He seems a funny guy though, and I like his podcast that you did with him too.
Otson, yeah, Otson is. I know Felix and Otson are really good friends, so that's probably why. Felix told him.
So Poppy, I'm going to
wrap it up.
I think
Al keeps asking who are you railing on iPoker MTT. I don't know. It sounds like he could be playing. I mean, we don't want to say. I don't know. I don't want to.
It's my housemate. I can't say. Screen it.
Yeah, I don't want to say screen it. Okay, what were you gonna say?
I think the main event started now.
Starts at 7. It starts in 1 hour and 15 minutes.
Sure, yeah, okay. All right, well, I'm going to watch my friend win the podcast ring. If he busts out now after the podcast finishes, then...
So ridiculous.
I was just trying to go until he kept, was in the, like, kept being in the tournament, so...
Crazy. I thought he busted too. I
assumed he was still in. He's going to tell. I assume he'd tell us if he busted out.
All right, so thanks for the questions. And you owe me a poem, actually.
I owe you a poem.
You told me you didn't tell me a poem by the end of the podcast.
I'll have to share a poem with you later.
All right, okay. I'm waiting.
But I promise I'll share a poem with you.
All right, cool. Sounds good. All right, guys. Thanks.
Pads, you want to follow Pads on Twitter? It's at Plano Pads on Twitter. His 2+2 thread I'll put in the description. Frozidov says this YouTube live stuff is great. I'm late, but it's my first time on here. Does it lag as much as Twitch? No, you can change the quality on YouTube or Twitch. You can change to lower. Boom. That's it. Pads. Patrick, talk to you. I'll talk to you soon on chat. And thanks for coming on the podcast. It was a lot of fun. Guys on YouTube, thanks for tuning in. Guys on Twitch, I'll stay here for an extra second. Take some comments, get some shout outs. And yeah, that's it. Peace out. Adios. See you guys later. I'm not sure when the next podcast will be. It might be with Dan Smith this week, but I'm not 100% positive which day. So follow my Twitter or the Facebook group. That's it. Peace out. Adios. See you guys later. Much love. See you guys.